This time last year, Kyle Busch stood on top of the NASCAR world, taking his 8th win of the season at Watkins Glen to lead the points going into the chase. But when the chase began, Kyle's hopes collapsed and the challenge was over. Fast forward to 2009 and Busch's season has imploded a good deal earlier. So much so that he arrives at the Glen in serious danger of missing the title playoffs. Tell me it's not over. Tell me it's not over. What would Wild Thing give for a Watkins Glen win today? NASCAR's second and final road course race of the season may be a day late, but a cup event at Watkins Glen International is worth waiting for. We're live for the Heluva good sour cream dips at the Glen. On Sunday, the decision to delay the start of the race came just 10 seconds before the command to start engines was due. But it coincided with a spectacular weather cell moving through the mountains. Lightning in the background was followed by strong winds and then the inevitable rain. With persistent drizzle, NASCAR was swift in rescheduling the race to Monday. The right decision, but tough for the fans, teams and television viewers. Hello everyone, it's the second week in a row that racing has been rescheduled to Monday after rain on Sunday. But the scenario for this dramatic road course remains the same, and the focus on that now crucial race to the chase is intense. To analyse the action today, our race driver John Mickle and motorsport journalist Tim Scott. Tim, thanks for joining us here on a Monday. Let's talk about the controversy that's blown up over the last week, particularly here in Europe, regarding the use of NASCARs in the wet.
Yeah, Goodyear is sitting there, you know, with rain coming down at the Glen, saying, look, we've got a tyre that can actually run in the wet. NASCAR's Busch Series raced in the wet for the first time last year in Montreal, but still the Sprint Cup Series at NASCAR refused to race in the wet. So the question is, could they have raced yesterday despite the rain? I mean, as you've said, it was very, very heavy and they wouldn't have got out probably in any circumstances. But the debate is there. When will NASCAR sanction the use of wet weather tyres on road courses?
Well, I think Tim summed it up very well there, John. I mean, the fact was that it was the right decision yesterday to run on Monday. We're happy to be back. And it's a lovely day.
Yeah, it's a lovely day. Yeah, definitely the right decision by NASCAR. It poured the rain, there was lightning, lit the sky up, and it took so long to dry the track. And if it had got started, they don't think they'd have got a whole race in. And because the chases are close and the fans, they need to guarantee the full distance. So I think it's a dead right decision.
But with fantastic weather today, these are live pictures coming from Watkins Glen. And as you can see, fractionally better than it was yesterday, John.
Cool, yeah, 100% better. It was like watching the rerun what we watched yesterday. It's the blue skies, good race, and hopefully we can get it all in.
Now then, our opener pretty much featured the man Kyle Busch, of course. Finds himself in deep trouble just outside of the race to the chase. I mean, really, this week he's got to do the business. He did it so well here last year.
Yeah, he's under a lot of pressure. I mean, last year he had 8 wins. You know, he come here, he won this one. He's got to come back again. He's got to get back on track. And he's got to find that sparkle he had last year. And if he doesn't, he's going to miss out for the chase. And it would be a shame if he wasn't in the chase. Because on his day, who can stop him?
Well, he swept both road course races last year, Tim, but at Infineon earlier this year, he only finished 22nd. So Kyle Busch at the moment is a shadow of his former self.
He blows hot and cold, doesn't he? And as John says, I don't think anyone doubts that he is the talent to on his day. He's just the best guy out there. Jeff Gordon has recently said, you know, I think this kid has more talent than anyone else in the whole field. He's just got to start stringing it all together and be consistent.
Talking of stringing it all together and being consistent, Jimmy Johnson, not one on a road course at Cup level, first pole position on a road course this weekend for Watkins Glen. Wouldn't bet against him, would you?
No, you can't. You always have to remember with someone like Jimmy Johnson that he, as a kid, he grew up dreaming of single-seaters, dreaming of racing in Champ Car and the Indy 500. He's road course racing's in his blood. And, you know, for him to come here and get a victory, his first victory on a road course, means a great deal.
Indeed, but it's Tony Stewart who scored his first Watkins Glen victory in 2002 and won again in 2004, 5 and 7, and he finished second in last year's race. Can he match it this year, I wonder? He's on top of the table now, 197 points ahead of Jimmy Johnson. Jeff Gordon, who's won four races over a five-year period at the Glen, is third. Kurt Busch remains fourth, up one spot to fifth after that win last week at Pocono is Denny Hamlin. Sixth is Carl Edwards, up one to seventh is Casey Kane, creeping up two more places this week is Juan Pablo Montoya, now in 8th. Ryan Newman drops 2 to 9th. Down 1 in 10th is Mark Martin. Matt Kenseth is now 11th. And Greg Biffle now holds that golden 12th spot. Kyle Busch must be working up a sweat in 13th. 101 points off the cut. Ryan Vickers, Clint Bowyer and David Ruderman are within 20 points of Busch and looking to leapfrog their way into the chase. Ruderman knows how tenuous making the chase can be. He was running in contention in Monday's event at Pocono Raceway, only to tangle with eventual winner Denny Hamlin and finish 29th, falling from 13th to 16th in the championship. Well, Watkins Glen International has been a yearly fixture on the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series schedule since 1986, but its first series race was well before that. Located just outside New York on the southern tip of Seneca Lake, Watkins Glen International first hosted NASCAR back in 1957. Once home to the American Formula One Grand Prix, the historic track known as the Glen is the second and final road course of the Cup Series. The 11 turns on the 2.45-mile track flip between flowing corners and short 90-degree bends with plenty of opportunity for overtaking. The boot at turn 7 is a reminder of the track's Formula One days. It's the faster of the two Cup road courses, and it was Mark Martin who set the race record in 1995 at 103.3 miles per hour. Here's a lap of the Glen with John.
Yep, coming to turn one, this is where a lot of the action will be. People try to overtake there, it goes downhill, a lot of wheel hopping as well, we've got to look out for that today. Come up to turn two, they'll be coming through the gears, as you can see, they'll take a little bit of kerb, they'll come uphill into turn three. Still coming through the gears, they should be in fourth gear by now, as they came down the straight. It bears right just on to start onto another straight, comes in this one, it goes into the bus stop. This is where the action happened, the nationwide race. It's very tight in here, but it's a very good place of overtaking. Got to watch out for the curbs, it unsettles the car as they go over all the curbs. Again a left and then a right again, and then it comes to a big sweeping right hand bend. Again, going through the gears, making sure they can get up to speed to another long straightaway that goes into turn 10. Turn 10 is another good place of overtaking, but it can be overshot, and if you do overshoot it, you go into the kitty litter, and you'll see that today where the brakes start failing. As you see, left hand turn into turn 10, another short straight into turn 11. This is the last bend of the track that goes into the start finish straight. Again, this is where the big crash happened last year, and that is a lap of Watkins Glen. It should be exciting now it's dry weather.
And a couple of other extra little features of this track, of course, John, is the fact that the only time they park with the car's door on the right-hand side. The pits are on the right of the cars as they come down pit road.
Yep.
So slightly disorientating perhaps for a driver.
It is the driver. Don't forget the pit crews as well. You know, they go over and they come backwards where they usually go over and go round. They're, you know, all roles reverse. So there'd be a lot of practicing before the Watkins Glen races on the pit stops and the fuel as well.
Just a little extra to watch out for. It's time now, though, to cross over to the historic Glen for those famous words.
Race fans, are you ready? On behalf of Heluva Good and all its employees, drivers, start your engines!
Happy. Very good. I'm up on this. Just make sure it'll start. As soon as it starts, just shut it back off. Yeah, I got you.
Scott Blake from Heluva Good starting us off then. We'll take a short break. When we come back, we should be set to go green for race 22 in the NASCAR Sprint Cup. The action's live from Watkins Glen next. Welcome back to our live coverage of race 22 of the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series. It's race 6 in the race to the chase. We're live for the uniquely titled Heluva Good Sour Cream Dips at the Glen, and it's a hell of a place to be. Time now to get over to the track. Your commentators are Dale Jarrett, Andy Petrie and Dr. Jerry Punch.
One of the favorite local landmarks here in the tiny village of Watkins Glen is the Seneca Lodge, where race drivers would come after an event and stand on the bar and hang their victory lane wreath on what over the years has become a wall of fame. Many of those great drivers have come again here to race at Watkins Glen. We have a star stud. If you look at all the champions, nationwide champions, cup champions, sports car champions, three drivers with extensive Formula One experience, two Indy 500 winners, and oh, by the way, five countries represented in today's field. It truly is Watkins Glen International. Our starting grid, and for the first time in his career, Jimmy Johnson on the pole on a road course. Now, starting outside of row two, our in-race reporter is Marcos Ambrose. Let's visit with Marcos.
Hey, Marcos, Dale Jarrett, ESPN. You have a copy? Hey, Marcos, my first question comes from our ESPN mailbag, and Nick from Marysville, Washington wants to know, what lessons did you learn from finishing third last year, and how do you plan to win this season?
Well, hopefully it'll be a lot easier at the front here just to look after my stuff. You know, we've got a great chance to win today's race, just like everybody else does, but I think it's going to be a lot easier to look after my tires, my brakes, or not having to pass the whole field. The way the strategy works here, if you start at the back, you've got to get off sequence, you end up passing twice as many cars what you really want. But I feel like we're in great shape here. We're going to just try to look after our stuff early on and put ourselves in good position towards the end.
Marcos, I've heard you say a number of times that you want to really be able to fit in with these Cup guys. You seem like you're doing that. You don't want to ruffle any feathers. It may take ruffling some feathers to win this race today. Are you prepared to do that?
Yeah, it may do at the end. Obviously, guys like Jimmy and Kurt here in front of me, they're looking after their chase spot. So I've got an advantage there that these guys may not be as aggressive as I intend to be if it comes down to that at the end. But right now, I'm happy with what I'm doing. The strategy I've had all season has worked well for me. I don't want to do anything different.
All right, Marcos, thanks for talking with us today. Good luck in that quest for that first Cup victory. And now Andy's going to talk to your crew chief, Frank Kerr.
Hello, Frank. Andy Petrie up here in the booth. Have you got us?
I do, Andy. How are you today?
Pretty good, Frank. We've been talking a lot about pit strategy, and this race really is going to come down to that last pit stop and when you make it. Tell us, walk us through how you make your decision on when to make that last pit stop.
Well, you know, here, you know, you count backwards, you know, what you can do on fuel mileage. But like a practice error, you know, we calculate what kind of mileage we're getting, but it's never the same in the race. So when it gets close to the end there for that last stop, we'll be calculating what we got on the first run, and then we're going to probably plan on a couple cautions and back it up a lap or two and hope for the best.
Yeah, Frank, that's when it kind of gets tricky, when you have to predict how many caution laps there are. But good luck in today's race, and hope you guys get your first win today.
Appreciate it, and thank all for coming back here today. It's going to be a great day.
It is going to be a great day. We will have onboard cameras in seven other cars, aside from Marcos Ambrose, not only outside the cars, but inside the cars. We'll be able to show you the shifting going on for Jeff Gordon's car, the four-time winner here. We'll also take you into the floorboard of Boris Said and watch all the fancy footwork from one of the best on a road course as we ride along with Boris, who starts in the ninth position. This historic road course was built in the wine country of central New York. Now, originally designed as a 3.4-mile layout for World Crest Grand Prix cars, it was shortened to its current 2.45-mile configuration when the stock cars began coming here on a regular basis in 1986. So let's take a look at these 11 turns.
Yeah, let's go down into turn one first off. High-speed, high-braking area right here. You got to really be careful not to get into these cars. You can create some problems if you're not careful, Andy.
Yeah, and one thing you're going to hear all day long is wheel hop. That's a term we use when you really get on the brakes hard and you lose the rear tires. They start hopping up and down, lose control of the car. You see Jeff Gordon a couple years ago lost the lead on this move right here where he wheel hopped getting into turn one.
Ooh, all too familiar with that one. As we head up the back straightaway through the S's to the back straightaway, very high-speed part of the track. Really can't go too wide through this part. We'll see some guys attempt it at times, but they really have to slow down. Now they're going up to the bus stop chicane where it's really difficult to get in another high braking area, but you have to be extremely careful here, Andy.
All the high braking zones are passing opportunities, and right here it can get real risky. We saw yesterday, or actually Saturday, in the Nationwide Series race, Marcos Ambrose made a daring pass on Kyle Busch in that bus stop chicane, and it came away with a victory, with Kyle Busch having to come to a complete stop in that zone.
As we head out of turn nine over to turn 10, another good passing area, but you have to be extremely careful here. If you can get that inside groove on your competitor, you have a good chance at making a pass. But if you get in there just a little bit too hot, You heard us talk about wheel hop. Here's a great example.
Yeah, here it is again, and you can see those rear tires just bouncing up and down. And when they're doing that, they're getting no traction whatsoever and no control, and you just wind up down here in the gravel trap.
Well, you think you're about finished, but you've got one more turn to negotiate. Turn 11 seems to be pretty instant in itself, but we saw last year just what can happen with a mistake here. Looks like a speedway crash. Watch all of these cars get involved.
You don't realize how fast the cars are going until they start hitting things, and you can see here it's very narrow coming off turn number 11.
This was last year, 11 cars involved in an incident that produced a 43-minute red flag, and there's Sam Hornish right into the barrels. Fortunately, he was okay. So much to think about on and off the racetrack. And how about the keys on how to be a maximum driver delivered by UPS?
Well, we've been talking about pit strategy, and identifying that pit window is so important in that strategy that you need to do that early. And also when to make that last stop. You use all the data that you've got. You make that last prediction of when to make that stop. But then on these last two, I'm going to need some help from the driver, Dale.
Yeah, number three there, stay on the course. Utmost importance. It's really hard if you get off this course at any time to have a very good day. A lot of these guys, especially battling for top 12 positions, have to do that today. And then taking care of the brakes. We talked about those three high braking areas. You really stand on the brakes there. You have to be careful with them at the other parts of the track.
Got to have so many talented people on pit road as well. And we've got one carrying a camera and microphone, a 15-year veteran and tire changer, Mark Hollywood Armstrong. He'll be changing the rear tires for Robbie Gordon. And Hollywood, what are your biggest challenges on pit road today?
Well, thanks, Doc. That could be the million-dollar question today. I mean, it's a backwards pit stop, so there's nothing the same from last week to next week. You just got to pay attention, focus, but don't overthink this pit stop. Hopefully we're going to do two. We can do three and still win this race with the Jim Beam Toyota. But most importantly, don't make a mistake. You can have a great day today in the pits and go to victory lane.
Hollywood, thank you very much. He's been doing it a long time, folks. He knows exactly what's at stake when that car comes down pit road and stops. Very difficult. Backwards pit stop. The car comes in backwards. You got to count backwards to calculate your fuel mileage at Watkins Glen. Oh, by the way, they drive backwards here on this course. Back in a moment.
What a difference a day makes. It almost makes me feel like singing when I look at a racetrack that's been transformed like this. Since yesterday, Sunday, it was miserable, it was cold, it was blowing, there was lightning, there was thunder all around the track. Now, sun's out, fans are at trackside. It's amazing how many of them there are here, Tim, at the moment. You'd have thought they'd have all gone to work, but where would you have rather been?
Well, this is it. The appeal of NASCAR, the fans have come back again in their droves, and it's, salute to them for keeping faith with the sport they love.
John, turn one is going to be a bit hectic, and of course the restarts, double file restarts here, that's going to be pretty spectacular as well.
Yeah, turn one is going to be very exciting. There's a couple of things really coming into turn one. It goes downhill, they've on about the wheel hopping, locking up the brakes and sliding. The two-file restart is going to be interesting as well, because obviously if you're on pole, you can choose inside or outside. They're going to choose inside because that's the first bend, but is the second person going to go get ratcheted back to fourth or fifth because the third and fifth are going to come through? It's going to be very interesting. They could lose a lot of spots. It's going to be, well, the first time really at Watkins Glen with a double-file restart.
Crew chief's got a lot of things to think about here, of course, as well. If you get a caution that's untimely as far as your strategy is concerned, it can put you back a long way. A lap around here is a massive deficit.
Yeah, absolutely. And, unlike the Indy cars when they come here, this is quite a short lap because of the modified layout that the NASCARs run on. And that's it, strategy and also luck. Let's face it, if the caution comes at the wrong time, doesn't matter how well you're going, that can just be not your day.
Well, of course, it is your day if you're sitting at home watching this, because you can email us live here at Sky Sports, NASCAR@skysports.com. It's along the bottom of the screen there. And we'd be very... happy to have your comments, and of course anything that you want to have answered as far as Watkins Glen is concerned, we'd be more than pleased to do that. So do get in touch with us, NASCAR@skysports.com. Okay, pole position for Jimmy Johnson. He's not going to be fazed from starting from there, that's for sure. In fact, it might be a bit of an advantage going down into turn one for the first time.
Yes, I think it will be. If he can get away, get out in front, hopefully he can stay there.
Let's go back to the track then and pick up with our commentators live for the start at Watkins Glen.
Getting set for the start of the Heluva Good at the Glen here. NASCAR Sprint Cup cars racing on a world-class road course on a Sunday, Monday afternoon. So sunny Monday here. It is a 90-lap race, 220.5 miles. The pit road speed, 35 miles an hour. The pace car will run 40. In terms of Sunoco fuel, Andy, the pit window, this is critical.
Yeah, that's what you can go, what we predict the green flag pit range is, or fuel range is, but we'll see cars coming in on that first pit stop a lot sooner than that because, like I said, they're going to be working backwards. Don't be surprised to see cars on pit road at lap 20 or maybe even before.
Let's check in with Dave Burns. And Jimmy Johnson getting ready to lead from the pole. His crew chief, Chad Knaus, had these words for the whole team moments ago.
They were a lot of people making mistakes and kind of take themselves out of this race. Do our game, do everything right, get all of our luck on. Don't speed on pit road, make sure he's clear, doing all that kind of stuff. That'll keep us here and get us in a solid top five here at the end of this day.
The last time Chad told me they were looking for a solid top five was 2 weeks ago at Indy. Guys, how'd they finish that day at Indianapolis?
Yeah, I think that was a pretty good day for them.
That was a top five. That's
yeah,
sure.
Definitely a solid top five.
And DJ, we talk about these drivers needing to get in a rhythm. How long is it going to take?
Yeah, it's going to take a little bit of time. That's one thing. They haven't been in a car since Saturday, so they have to get back into that mode of doing something that they don't do twice a year. So we'll see a few mistakes here early on.
And by the way, could we see a repeat of the contact we saw at Sonoma between Jimmy Johnson and Kurt Busch? They start side by side in row one, and that contact cost Kurt Busch what he believes would have been a top three or four finish and maybe even a shot at victory lane. As our Brad Doherty said yesterday, we expect a wall-to-wall brawl at Watkins Glen. He'll be pushing and shoving. Folks, glad to have you with us here on a Monday afternoon. The world's greatest drivers in stock cars as we turn them loose at Watkins Glen.
Didn't take them long to get three wide back there, did it?
Man, look at Kurt Busch. Kurt Busch. Get the big run on the outside.
Yeah, he's able to clear Jimmy Johnson up as they start up the S's.
Man, that was a power move right there. He took a lesson from his brother. He made that move in the Nationwide race, Kyle did, and made a pass, and looks like they learned something from that.
That might let some guys look as we have double file restarts later on as to which side they're going to choose.
Ambrose looking to the inside of Hamlin, will fall back in line. Looking out the front of Marcus Ambrose's car. Ambrose very good up here in turn nine.
Yeah, he's not going to surprise too many with that move in that chicane anymore, is he, after Saturday?
They've seen that movie.
David Stremme there in the fifth spot hanging on. That's where he started. Good run for those guys. He was pretty excited about his chances here.
So he's taking a look on Ambrose here, getting into the left-hander.
Have a hard time outbreaking him into that corner. As you can see now, it may cost him a spot.
Yeah, Ryan Newman behind him watching Stremme make that move. And Newman trying to get a position away. One lap complete, and Kurt Busch is the leader. Kyle Busch there at the top of your screen trying to make a move.
Yeah, he makes that fake to the inside. Now going to the outside of Ryan Newman. He'll follow Newman and go by Stremme in turn one.
You see Stremme get really wide there, trying to give some room as Denny Hamlin tries to put some pressure on Jimmy Johnson. Take away that second spot.
Johnson able to hold him off through the S's. Now here is the backstretch where he used it. I guess drafting does come into play a little bit here.
Yeah, you can definitely use the draft. You're up about 180 miles an hour before you start getting on the brakes and start downshifting, so you can definitely use that to your advantage.
You can see Ambrose, he just makes a peek every time they get to a corner, but I don't think you're going to see a lot of aggressive moves this early in the race. I think the thing is that they just want to stay in line here, stay caught up. They're actually letting Kurt Busch get away just a little bit. He's got about a three-quarters of a second lead so far. Hamlin looking inside of the
Johnson. It's like he's got an opportunity to make the pass here. He's going to be in the wrong spot as they get to turn 11, though. If he can carry some momentum, could get three wide here down the front straightaway if we're not careful.
Maybe Marcus Ambrose takes advantage of this side-by-side action. Ambrose, who do you follow in turn one? Obviously, you want to stay on the inside.
Yeah, but Denny Hamlin's made this work pretty well, and we saw Kurt Busch pass Jimmy Johnson on that high side. See if he's able to get off of there. Johnson's not ready to give that spot up here. This is pretty dicey going down into turn two, staying side by side. Somebody's going to have to give here.
And Jimmy Johnson is the one that gives. Pretty smart early in the race.
Denny Hamlin won at Pocono a week ago, last Monday to be exact, by being aggressive. And now he's aggressive in the early laps of Watkins Glen. Here is, speaking of aggressive, here's Marcus Ambrose, and he falls back in behind Jimmy Johnson.
Yeah, you see Jimmy Johnson making that defensive move to the right. He did that early on before Marcus could actually get inside, and that'll protect that move from making it work, getting in that corner.
Yeah, and what Jimmy was protecting from, he was able to he relinquished and gave that spot up to Denny Hamlin, but he didn't want to give more than that because he had to get out of the throttle up through this, as that gave Ambrose an opportunity to get a real run on him. So that's what you'll see these guys make that blocking effort.
You see Kyle Busch in the 18 right behind the guy that passed him in the final laps on Saturday. And surprising, I'll see if Kyle Busch is going to pay him back a little bit here. Let's follow along and see if, because Kyle Busch wasn't real happy about that surprise move that Ambrose pulled off on Saturday.
Well, but I think he understood it, and I'm sure after he's thought about it a couple of days, hey, I might want to try that myself, and he understood a little more of it. He's got, it looks like he has a really fast race car here today. That's a good thing for him as he's trying to work his way back in to that top 12 in the points. See, Jimmy Johnson struggling just a little bit. What are they saying, Dave?
Right now, Jimmy reporting that the car is very loose. Crew Chief Knaus reminding him that the car does tighten up. It's always like this, but Jimmy had to give up those first two spots because of a loose race car.
Yeah, we expected the track to be a little bit green when we started this race, and so the crew chiefs and the drivers are going to try to have to be patient here and let that transition happen before they make their decision on how to make that first adjustment.
Thus far, everyone trying to find their rhythm, and they have found it. We have not had an incident, and the inner loop was a big concern. And now it is Kurt Busch pulling away. Denny Hamlin in second spot, Johnson, and Marcus Ambrose is running fourth. Vince.
And as you mentioned, Marcus Ambrose trying to hold off Kyle Busch, who is challenging from behind, and the spotter telling Marcus Ambrose, use the whole track, don't be defensive this early in the race course, or in the race, run your race on the race course. So Kyle Busch is pressuring, but Marcus Ambrose being urged to just run his race.
Juan Pablo Montoya, there's the 42 car. We've been trying to work on the inside of Ryan Newman to get the spot, and he will get it. That is sixth position. Newman back to seventh spot. We are five laps in of 90, which will comprise the NASCAR Sprint Cup race at Watkins Glen. Team Penske went to a couple of different road courses and tested. They wondered how it would help their road racing. Well, I think we have an answer at least early on, because it is Kurt Busch out front, and he is pulling away as the leader. Busch, Hamlin, Johnson, Ambrose, and Kyle Busch. That's a top five.
Eight nationwide champions, six Sprint Cup champions, five sports car champions, three ex-Formula One drivers, two Indy 500 winners, and five nationalities. What a lineup at Watkins Glen for race 22 of the NASCAR Sprint Cup. We're live on Monday for the rescheduled race from yesterday's rainout. Let's go back to the track then, as Kurt Busch leads.
Back at Watkins Glen, Kurt Busch's interval now 2.55 seconds between him and Denny Hamlin, the second place car. Jimmy Johnson back in third, Ambrose fourth, and Kyle Busch is fifth. There's a side-by-side move, and what a surprise. Boris said, the road racing expert, making a move and getting by Ryan Newman.
Now, Ryan had run up about the fifth spot there early, but he's starting to lose some spots, so sure he'll be some adjustments made on his car. Here we're right along with Boris said. Watch his speed. He's up through this. As you can see, you want to get wide open and stay there. He's going to shift gears there. They have a crash down in turn one. Bobby Labonte.
Go on, man. Get it going. Good hole behind the 34 right here. Go, go, go.
No caution as of yet.
We will stay green as Bobby slid off and now gets it back in line. Right behind David Reagan.
Yeah, turn one's a difficult spot during the race, no matter if it's a restart, after you run a few laps, and it actually becomes even increasingly more difficult as you start to lose your fuel load. Watch here, see, don't think Bobby really knew that Jeff Burton was there. It's really hard for the spotters to see a lot of these places, too. You have to position them around the racetrack.
Yeah, Jeff Burton got a little damage to his left front fender on that little contact.
And here's a turn that's always an issue down to turn one. Look at Ambrose looking that he will think better of it. Not only is it difficult to negotiate, but it's downhill.
He's going to show Jimmy Johnson that move a few times, and if he gets close enough, Jimmy will let him have that. He's not going to risk too much here early in the race.
Let's go back and show you some of the footwork in the floorboard of Boris said. Now, Boris actually teaches a lot of the regulars in oval track racing and Sprint Cup how to become road racers.
Yeah, you can see he's kind of feathering the throttle here. He's going to change gears here just a second. Right there's one. He's up in the high gear now. Down, he's not going to lift until he gets up here. You can see him tapping the brake, getting him ready. Now, heel and toe right here. Toe on the brake, over to matching up the RPMs as he goes through the bus stop. It's just great footwork. He uses his right foot for the gas, for the brake. Then he'll bring his left foot in here sometimes on the brake. You see, as he goes around turn nine, it's a place that you want to get wide open as soon as you can. Changing gears pretty late there coming out. They may change one more time. So you can see him getting his brakes ready to get into turn 10. Downshifts. Just great footwork by an extremely talented road racer.
How hard is that to learn from someone who's been an oval track racer and has never heel and toed in the past?
Well, a lot of these guys don't have to do it now. That's the way that I learned to do it, and it's very difficult in these stock cars because you really don't have a lot of room. You're not stretched out. And talking to Boris and Ron Fellows and these guys, they have a lot more rooms. We see Montoya making a pass around Kyle Busch to take over that fifth spot. But these guys, a lot of the guys now, just use their left foot on the brake and right foot on the gas because you don't have to do that with the transmissions, Andy.
Well, one thing I saw in that shot with Boris Sid was he downshifting two gears there because he was going up two and you only saw really one downshift, and I just wonder if he was coming from fourth to second.
That's exactly right, yeah.
And that might be, that's about the only way you can make that shift is doing that heel and toe type clutch move there.
It makes it more difficult. Yeah, that's the only way that you can do that. So we see Kyle Busch is falling back to the sixth spot. What are they saying to Kyle Busch's pits, Dave?
Why don't we hear it straight from Kyle himself? Here's his radio. That tight with the front is something they worked on in final practice. I talked to Steve Addington about it. He said he still wanted better turning from that front end. It wasn't terrible. We made small changes to try to correct it, but that's still part of the problem.
Yeah, we saw Kyle in the pre-race show yesterday talk about that was the one thing that he had been fighting with his cars. We see Marcus Ambrose here once again taking a look to the inside of Jimmy Johnson, but hopefully that's something they can adjust on a little bit more as the track rubbers up some here today.
You know, with Ambrose making that move and showing that front end on the inside, after what he did on Saturday and surprising Kyle Busch, everybody's got to think when he shows that nose, he might be able to pull that same move. So you got to be watching for it.
Yeah, and you're really just trying to get out of that guy's mirror sometimes and make him think that and maybe he'll lift. But he has to realize he's dealing with a three-time champion right there, that Jimmy's pretty aware of where the guy is when you take off. But you can surprise him sometimes, just as Marcos did on Saturday.
Car still single file up the back straightaway, 1,800 feet coming out of the S's until you get to the inner loop. And the biggest mover early in the race, and maybe a bit of a surprise thus far, the 88 car, Dale Earnhardt Jr., has moved up eight positions all the way to 24th spot. And the junior is starting to get a little racy here, Shannon.
Well, this is after a dismal weekend. In final practice this weekend, Dale Earnhardt Jr. told his crew chief Lance McGrew that he had no confidence in the car at all. Lance McGrew told me that the car was really tight. So what they did was they just took the best that they could get in practice. They put a spin on it for Junior, and that's the way they started the race. Junior just radioed in and said that the car is loose. They've asked him to make some changes inside that car to try to fix it. A little bit of front brake for Junior inside that 88.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. is starting to get better and better as the laps tick away. And as you said, after a very tough weekend. Now, his teammate in Hendrick Motorsports just lost a position here up in turn 11.
Boy, Ambrose very aggressive on that move coming out of turn 10, which set up a great pass here in 11.
Yeah, it looked like Jimmy got a little bit loose right here as he gets up on the front strips there. You can see Ambrose able to stay in the throttle. Jimmy, I think, at this point in time, just tired of having him right there in the air.
Clear, all clear. Good job.
Just 11 laps into this race.
Hit your marks now. You can have a car coming out of the pits down there.
So Kurt Busch, the leader, Denny Hamlin in second spot. Now it's Marcus Ambrose third, and Ambrose was the fastest car in both practice sessions on Saturday. Everyone knows he may be the guy to beat here, even early on.
Marcus Ambrose then, the Australian, really, really on it with the 47 car at the moment, but we would expect nothing less from the Australian, will be Tim Scott.
Absolutely. You know, he won the Nationwide Series race here on Saturday. He's got good third place here last year in the Sprint Cup race. And all that experience in big Australian V8s back home, down under, he's primed to make his mark here.
It amazes me, John, just how technical these cars are on this type of course. There's such a fine line of getting them right, even on a road course. They seem to be relying very much on their crew chiefs here. for minor adjustments on what is a big, heavy, wobbly car with hardly any brakes.
Yeah, I think you hit the nail on the head. They are so big and cumbersome, and it takes so much to make sure these cars are dialed in for this track, as they're not designed to go around here, and the crew chief do a great job really making them go around as well as they do. As for Marcus Ambrose, yeah, he's definitely on the money. He come in as the favourite. You know, I think for the first couple of laps, he's found his feet, and now I think he'll start picking off one at a time. But they are such a big cumbersome car for a road circuit.
A lot of people at home are enjoying this evening. They've just come home from work. Raukan is a man who's written to us many, many times. I'm assuming it's a man, of course, with a name like that. I can't quite make up if that's a handle or a real name, but you can tell us in your next email to us. You know, this Monday racing is great. It's like having an event twice a week, isn't it? Track pass warmed up, dinner's nearly ready. You lot are on the telly. Let's go racing, boys. Raukan, pleased to have you with us. The debate that I think David Tuckman started last night regards to either getting rid of road courses or adding more road courses seems to be a consensus that more road courses would be nice than one in the chase. Ian Paul, he's an Ambrose fan at the moment and aiming for Marcus Ambrose to win this if he can, but he's got a good point, I think, having one in the chase, Tim.
Yeah, it would be great, you know, to see some more road courses. Virginia International Speedway, is one that some of the teams have actually tested at, and would be a good venue. It's quite a long course, quite wide. Certainly Montoya here is giving Jimmy Johnson a hard time, and that's what Marcus Ambrose was able to get past Johnson quite easily, and Montoya seems the same.
We've got a new viewer to NASCAR on Sky, Dave from Leon C. Are you having a laugh at me, Dave, here? What's the difference between NASCAR and IndyCar? Well, if you really genuinely don't know that, I'm sorry if I sounded a little bit like I was taking the mickey, but it's a pleasure to have you with us. If you'd like to check out skysports.com on the motorsport page, we'd be happy to help you out on there. But very briefly, these are NASCARs, and obviously IndyCar, if you were with us last night, you'd have seen they're open-wheel cars, a bit like Formula One cars, but not quite as technical. That's how it looks at the moment. Of course, you can check it out, www.skysports.com/motorsport, or just go to skysports.com and then look for the motorsport link, which is at the top of the page. Take a look on there. I've got a page on there as well that sometimes when I've got a bit of an outrageous opinion to vent, you'll find it on there, and you can join us again on that if you'd like to. We're on board with Jeff Gordon at the moment, working our way around. Email us if you want to as well, nascar@skysports.com. That's where we are at the minute. And we'd be pleased to hear a bit more from you. Join in with the debate over whether they should go racing in the wet on road courses, whether there should be more road courses, particularly if there should be one in the chase, just around out all types of track in the main event, if you like, of the NASCAR season. So we're on lap 15 of 90. As I just checked, I thought it was 85 at one time there, but there you go, it's 90. It's at the top of the screen. If all else fails, read the instructions, Ewan. Let's go back to the track then and catch up with our commentators.
Jeff Gordon, a four-time winner here, his last win coming in 2001. But folks, in the last 7 years, it's hard to believe he has had only one top 10 finish here at Watkins Glen.
Well, it was a mistake that took him out of the contention to win the race 2 years ago. So he's had good cars, and I expect him to be into this thing before the day's over. Just hard to pass.
Yeah, here's the one car, Martin Truex, his last top five finish in a Cup car. Came here at this race a year ago, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. will take advantage of the opening underneath Elliott Sadler to follow Truex by.
Yeah, good racing. These guys have been battling pretty hard for a few laps.
Kurt Busch is the leader, but don't look now behind him. Here is Denny Hamlin and Marcus Ambrose in the last couple laps. Guys, both the 11 and the 47 cars are faster than Busch.
And their lap times are almost mirroring each other while they're running down Kurt Busch. And once they've cleared Jimmy Johnson, you can see now Marcus Ambrose has really pulled away. You can see how fast his car is.
And he might not be happy with his car. Is that right, Vince?
What's amazing is that Ambrose is so good when you're looking at the stopwatch and how quickly he's putting these laps down. But Marcos on the radio says he really feels like the car's too loose. He doesn't feel like he's got the grip that he needs. The front end is too stiff. They came back on the radio to him and said, well, then you're really driving that car because you look really good. That's a nice comment.
Back in fourth position, Jimmy Johnson. We told you the story. His first ever pole on a road course. He has never won on a road course. And right now trying to hold off the pressure coming from Montoya. Let's listen to the 48 radio.
Loose, man. Almost spun out getting into 10. It's going to tighten up, man. It's going to tighten up. Same thing as this last time we were here. You're going to be fine.
You don't want me to tell you what it's doing now?
But I'm just trying to keep you informed, too. It's going to get tighter. You're doing great.
Yeah, they're kind of at odds a little bit about what the racetrack's doing. Jimmy says, you know, the car's loose, and Chad's saying it's going to tighten up. He says, well, you still want me to tell you what it's doing, right? He says, yeah, he does. He wants the information, but he just wants to make sure that Jimmy knows and doesn't panic that the track is going to change a little bit.
Yeah, that's what you have to be careful of, and especially with the conditions that we have today being so much different than what we've seen over the weekend, that you don't make too big of an adjustment there because, as he said, this racetrack is probably going to tighten up or their car is.
Remember, these two guys were the principals at Indianapolis a couple of weeks ago. Montoya leading 116 laps, had the dominant car for the day, but made a mistake on pit road, and it was Jimmy Johnson that went to victory lane.
Debris in the inner loop.
Well, we got a caution, and this is just a little bit before their pit windows. A lot of guys will probably have a decision to make when they come around here for the opening of pit road.
What would you do?
I'd pit. I'd just come on in here and take a chance on it and see what happens.
So the window, as you, by your calculations, would be lap 20, so we are two laps shy. So you go ahead and come in and roll the dice?
Well, you know, you're going to have to count on getting a few more caution laps here to stretch all this out. But when they fall right here at that pit window, especially when it's this close, you've got to consider making the stop right now.
Yeah, one thing it will do is put a lot of people on pit road probably at the same time. These pit boxes are really small, so you have to be careful.
The caution was for debris on the racetrack. We'll take a quick break and come back and cover the first pit stop. This could be critical. Got to get it full of fuel and cannot speed.
We're under the first full course caution of the day at Watkins Glen International. Debris was the call. That's now being cleaned up, but we expect the cars on pit road any time. This is the Heluva Good Sour Cream Dips at the Glen, and you're looking into the cab, one of the drivers. Let's get back to the track then for the pit stops.
Under caution for the first time today here at Watkins Glen International. This is going to be critical, folks, because they are just outside their first fuel window, but it looks like most of the leaders will come on the pit road as they come around behind the pace car this time, and you got to get it full of fuel. Critical for these guys not only to get it full of fuel, but be able to get all the tires on and not make a mistake, and we're being told that we could have green next time by.
Yeah, that's going to be a little tricky for these cars to get on pit road, make the pit stops, and get double file by the time we do get the green. So we'll be looking for the flagman here to see if we get the one to go signal while these cars are pitting.
Miles an hour on pit road, and Kurt Busch will lead the line down pit road. Let's go to Vince.
The 47 of Marcos Ambrose did not come on pit road. There had been a debate. Marcos wanted to come because he's not happy with the car, but crew chief Frank Kerr urged him to stay out to get the clean air. That's what he's got. Jamie?
It was a must for Tony Stewart in the 14 to pit. He said he's loose. He wants a spring rubber in both sides, a wedge adjustment on both sides, four tires and Sunoco fuel. He told the team he needs to do it now. He needs more drive off, so he told his crew chief exactly what he wanted. Shannon?
Juan Pablo Montoya says the car's a little bit loose getting to the left. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment on the left rear. It is four tires for the 42. Dave.
Second place, Denny Hamlin is a little loose and a little tight. Track bar and air pressure adjustment, four tires. Leader Kurt Busch, his car was loose, four tires. He's going to win the race off pit road, barely getting around Jimmy Johnson.
Good job, guys. Good job, man.
Great job on pit road. You see Kyle Busch getting the spots there. Biffle up, Montoya back too. Everybody putting on four tires. Paul Menard up five positions on this exchange.
Yeah, that's a great job by that 98 team. But we got a penalty coming for Denny Hamlin. Too fast exiting. Man, that's going to be a costly penalty right now.
Also the 88 car,
Denny.
Dale Jr. too fast on exit.
See everybody getting kind of caught up in this race off of pit road, and you see Denny Hamlin trying to get by the two, just stood on the gas a little too hard in that last segment.
Okay, guys, why did the 47 stay out? 47, Ambrose stayed out, Casey Kane and the 43 all stayed on the racetrack. Your thoughts?
Well, I think it's a big mistake by both of these cars. I think it's going to put Marcus Ambrose in a catch-up position later in the race. It's really going to be tough for him to win this thing with this strategy. I know that they couldn't, that, you know, this was outside their window, but, you know, you can count on the caution laps all the way from here to the end of the race to try to get there. I would have gambled on this one.
Yeah, sometimes it's important to stick with your strategy because that's what you want to do. But when the opportunity presents itself, as you just said, so close, then can make a difference.
Let's talk to our in-race reporter here, Marcus Ambrose.
Hey, Marcus, Dale Jarrett, you have a copy?
10-4 dial.
You're one of the three cars that decided to stay out. Was that your decision?
Yeah, it's probably a joint decision. We're just trying to run our own race here. We've got some changes we want to make to the car. We thought under caution we may lose too many spots. We've got a fuel strategy game we're playing out here, and hopefully it'll work in our favor.
Okay, quickly, what are you fighting with your car?
Track's just green, not a lot of grip out there, and I'm just feeling like the car's on top of the racetrack. Haven't got very good forward drive. That's probably my biggest concern right now is forward drive.
All right, buddy, good luck.
So again, to set up what happened, we had three cars stay on the racetrack. Marcus Ambrose, Casey Kane, and Reed Sorensen. Those three stayed on the track. We also had three drivers that are going to be penalized for too fast on exit. They will have a pass-through penalty. That is the 11 car of Denny Hamlin, the 88 of Dale Earnhardt Jr., and the 31 of Jeff Burton. All three of those cars will have to come in. Shannon.
Guys, there's been an injury down here on pit road. Dwayne Ogle, the rear tire changer of the sixth car, the team has told me he was hit by the 42 car on pit road. He is favoring his right side right now, and the guys are tending to him. We'll follow this up.
So if we can see the contact, there's Montoya leaving.
Yeah, it gets tight down there. You see here. He does. He gets a piece of that front end on the 42 right here.
Yeah, this is extremely tight pit road, and
well, you see, Montoya had the 16 car on his outside, so he was trying to cut it close, but, oh, man, cut it just a little bit too close. You got to be careful down there.
Now, for the first time at Watkins Glen, the new rules, a double-file restart shootout style. Lead cars up front, side-by-side, coming down. It's Ambrose and Casey Kane. As the green flag comes back out, and we'll see who will win that chase to turn one.
These guys have to stay in line until they get across the start-finish line once again.
Well, look at Jimmy Johnson all the way down on the bottom of the racetrack.
Oh, that's not careful, guys. Man, Jimmy does a good job right there not to make contact.
Montoya off the track, and he
gets
back. Man,
look how wide the track gets over there. They're using a lot of that runoff area.
Those three drivers that were speeding on pit road just had to go to the tail end of the longest line here on this road course. So that's where all of those guys had to restart.
Yeah, they did not have to come down pit road and get farther behind. Just starting at the back was a penalty.
Kurt Busch in behind those two guys of the 9 and the 43, unable to get by. And the 47 just pulling away.
He got a big launch right there on the start. And this is what he wanted. This is the reason he stayed out, is to get that clean air, see what his car will do out there. And but I still think he's going to have to play catch-up later in the race.
Double file restart can be helpful to some drivers because it pairs them up side by side, and that's been a big help for that 24 car.
Well, Jeff's able to make up some spots. They did a good job in the pits. It got him a lot closer to the front with the double file restart, and a little aggressive driving on his part got him up there in a lot better position than when he went in the pits.
Oh, and a little contact, a little chain reaction right here.
55
car
around.
Patrick Carpentier's car spun around.
Trying to get it started here. He's going to lose a lot of positions. Now he gets it going.
We will stay green at Watkins Glen. Jimmy Johnson again looking to the inside of Reed Sorensen.
And Kyle Busch kind of opened up the door for Jimmy there, but he wasn't able to take advantage. I think his car is still a little bit on the loose side, especially on the fresh tires.
Yeah, look for Jimmy Johnson to make a move down into the chicane under braking and try to get by Reed Sorensen. Right here he does. He goes, makes that move right here. It's a replay of this chain reaction.
Yeah, this is all what's happening. You see David Streamy got into the 55 there. Yeah, as all of that was happening, let's look at the back of Jeff Gordon's car here. This is what happens. These guys had to slow up.
Paul Menard getting it slowed.
It's a tight racing in turn 11.
And while we were watching that, we mentioned Jimmy Johnson did get by the 43 of Reed Sorensen. There's the 48 car of Johnson. has moved up into the fifth position and will set his sights on Kyle Busch. Let's listen in on the 42 of Juan Pablo Montoya.
Did I hit somebody?
Yeah, I'll get it.
Sorry.
Yes?
Is the guy okay?
I'll see.
Is the guy okay?
They're checking right now. He looks all right.
Sorry about that.
See Montoya concerned about the number six crew member here. We'll go get him checked out here. He's got some ice on his thigh. Hopefully, you know, his elbow, I see. Man, he's got a bandage on his elbow. Hopefully he's going to be okay.
Marcus Ambrose led the first lap in his Cup Series career last week at Pocono when he was thought he was going to have a top 10 finish. Got shuffled out there into contact with David Ruderman and Denny Hamlin. And now leading again three wide, headed toward the inner loop. And folks, that won't work even two wide.
No, there goes Strimmy through the grass. He's going around in front of these guys.
Oh, man. Jeff Gordon gets a piece of it.
So does Kevin Harvick.
Harvick. Got Carl Edwards right there into the side of Jeff Gordon.
Strimmy trying to get it fired, and we will have a full course caution.
Right side damage, rear damage on the screen here, Roy.
Yeah, a lot of debris down there. They're going to have to clean it up.
Guys, get ready to cut the bumper cover off, and right front damage, the splitter's broke.
Yeah, Harvick got the worst of that.
Boy, what a year it's been for Richard Childress Racing and Kevin Harvick outside the top 20
in points.
What
the hell were those guys doing?
Yeah, sometimes you wonder that as a driver, just what
was
going on there.
Everything ready, guys. We're going to need your sheet metal for the left front fender.
See what happens. You see Strimmy gets off into the grass. That's never very good. Just loses total traction as he tries to come back onto the pavement, spins around in front of these guys. Casey Mears just snuck by. Gordon couldn't quite get by, and then Harvick into the right front of David Strimmy.
Now watch Jeff Gordon's viewpoint here. Watch Mears get by.
Right here, you think Jeff Gordon's missed this, barely gets a little bit of contact, thinks he's okay, and then he gets hit by the 29 right behind the right front wheel.
Well, Carl Edwards did a nice job to keep the nose of his car out of that catch fence.
Yeah, I thought he had gathered a part of this, but he actually gets by right here and is able to come by without any damage to either side of his car.
Stay in the middle here.
See, Strimmy was trying to make a pass there on Brian Vickers, and he just miscalculated and got into the inner loop a little too fast and shot him through the grass.
The two most heavily damaged cars, a 12 of Strimmy and the 29 of Harvick.
Jeff Gordon got substantial damage there, too. Oh, we got a little more retaliation from an earlier accident.
Yeah, that came from when they were in turn 11, and Strimmy got into the right rear quarter panel and spun Carpentier out.
Strimmy now trying to get some serious repairs made on pit road. What a good weekend has been for him thus far. The great qualifying effort for this 12 car, best of the year, fifth. And there is the damage on the right front.
Yeah, car looks pretty good from here, but we get a shot from that other side, you're going to see a whole lot of damage there on that right front all the way down the side of the car.
And all those spots we were talking about that he made up there with good pit work and the double file restarts is going to be taken away because he's
right
got some work to
if
do.
If they all pit, I want to change right sides only. If no one pits, I want to change four. I want you on pit road when it's open. The right rear is off.
I think they're going to be okay. They get a little repair job done on this car. I think the car will be okay. It's just all those spots he's going to have to give up.
Okay, and how about the 47 strategy now? What are they thinking? They actually stayed out there longer than I thought they were going to.
Yeah, they can go farther still. They can still go a few more laps, and I don't know if they'll pit under this caution or not. If they do, it's just going to be devastating. They're going to go back to 35th or 6th. That's the problem with this strategy. I mean, you know, if Ambrose pits now, he's going to give up a ton of spots.
Okay, now a lot of these guys are in the window. Now, if you're Frankie Kerr, what do? Do you go ahead and bring him in, or do you let him stay out there a little bit longer?
At this point, I think I'd leave him out there because a green flag pit stop might even lose him less spots. What are they thinking down there, Vince?
That's exactly right, Andy, because Frank Kerr says we're still not in our fuel window. He asked Marcos what he wanted to do, and Marcos said, well, we better stick with the game plan. You know, on that first set of sequences and the first set of pit stops, Marcos was really more in favor of coming to pit lane, and Frank was telling him, no, we need to stay out. So it's been interesting, the debate back and forth between the two, but they're really a lot better in clean air, so they're sticking with the game plan and staying out front, not in the fuel window just yet for Ambrose.
Well, Vince, we're going to get to see how the strategy works out between these two cars. We see the
9 car, Casey Kane on pit road, and also Sorensen. We'll see where they line up on this restart and then see where Ambrose winds up after he makes his stop. So it'll be a good way to gauge how the strategy works. But it's going to put these cars way back, Shannon.
Strategy already playing out on pit road. Casey Kane in the 9. He's loose in. They're going to make a wedge adjustment. Tires and air pressure for Casey Kane, guys. He went to victory lane at Sonoma, and they hope to do it again today. Guys?
Yeah, 42 car, Juan Pablo Montoya, he pitted also. I can't hardly believe they did that after they made their other stop, but making a second pit stop.
And let's watch Mark Hollywood Armstrong, the rear tire changer for Robbie Gordon, go to work.
Got the hood up here, got some kind of problem. See Hollywood working on the hood pin here. Don't know what kind of problem they have under there.
Bobby Gordon, the winner here in 2003, and has had top five finishes here in 3 of the last 5 years, but having trouble here on lap 24 on pit road as they are under the hood here of his Toyota.
Okay, working on that screen area, the grill area. They have some rags out there. May have an oil line leak. What's wrong down there, Dave?
Hey, I'm in the 39 pit right now, Andy, with Ryan Newman, who qualified 6th, a very fast race car, but almost immediately alternator problems. They're going to change the batteries during this pit stop.
So troubles starting to mount for some of the regulars here and some of the favorites. Ryan Newman in the pits. Remember, he's one of the guys in the top 10 in points.
You're watching live coverage from Watkins Glen International. Of course, it's race 22 in this year's NASCAR Sprint Cup Series. And you joined John Mickle, David Tuckman there for a moment. He was with us on Sunday. Of course, this is the rescheduled rain out from yesterday. And with us is Tim Scott today. And very pleasant it is to have him with us too. Now, John Jackson is one of our emailers. Hi from John Jackson in Telford. I'm a big JPM fan. JPM for the win, he says. Well, I think there's a few people that are with you on that one today. I think there should be more road races in NASCAR, and yes, there should be a race in the rain at road races, but only at a road race. That seems to be a consensus that many, John, are with you on as far as the emails we're receiving here at the moment. A lot of people watching tonight as well are first-timers for NASCAR, John Mickle. I've got to say that it's great to have newcomers to the sport, but Monday nights seems to be a bit of a favourite at the moment. I have to say that our schedulers don't like it too much around here.
No, they don't, but the rain for the last 2 weeks has made us come back on Mondays, and it does open up a new audience because obviously people don't get the opportunity on Sundays to watch it, and it's good that new people are watching it because I still think it's one of the best motorsports there is.
Tim, some are saying that you only need to race in the rain if you're in Formula One and some of the other formulas because they're so boring, so you need it to make it exciting. Without all you need with NASCAR is a nice dry day.
Yeah, for these guys around here, it's certainly entertaining, isn't it? They're slipping and sliding around enough just with these big bulky cars in the dry. I mean, that is one of the considerations. These cars are tricky to drive on a road course. They're not really made for this kind of a circuit. And so in the wet, they really are a handful, especially with all that power and torque.
Yeah, you're right, Tim. The worst things for these two cars is power, getting the grip down and stopping them. And that's what a road course is all about. They're designed to go flat out around an oval.
Richard Hutchinson's been on as well. Rich in Hartlepool. Hi, guys. Looking forward to an unplanned evening of NASCAR on a Monday night. At the top of the show, our American colleagues mentioned that the field held 3 drivers from Formula One experience. Obviously, JPM is one. Scott Speed's brief spell with Toro Rosso means he's the second. But who's the third driver? Well, looking down the entry list, of course, Max Pappas in the number 13 Germain Racing car this weekend. So you'll be able to keep an eye on him. NASCAR at skysports.com. Do join us if you want to join in with a few more emails. Now then, David Stremme's making a bit of a nuisance of himself again today, isn't he? He got himself a little hot under the collar last time out in the last rain-off that we had on the Monday. Again, John, at the minute, he's getting himself in all sorts of trouble here.
Yeah, he just overshoots his bend, goes across the grass, and then just loses it. And then he was lucky he didn't wipe out more cars than what he did. I mean, obviously, Kevin Harvick, Jeff Gordon's definitely got some damage. Kyle Edwards might have got some split damage, but it could have been a lot worse.
Yes, that could be argued, of course. I think Jeff Gordon's not going to be too happy as far as that's concerned. And certainly Kevin Harvick, because that's just what he didn't need, is to be taken out with some front-end damage like that.
He's had a bad enough year as it is, and he didn't need David doing that. And David Stremme, after last week at Pocono, he's been quite consistent, isn't he?
I call that Ambrose corner there now as well, after he took Kyle Busch at that particular point yesterday in a Nationwide to take the win. He surprised them all, but David Stremme didn't quite get it as perfect.
No, he didn't. Far from it.
So there you go then, the field are under our second caution of the day. Lap 23, we had a full course caution. David Stremme causing the trouble after ramming Kevin Harvick and Jeff Gordon getting caught up as well. Carl Edwards was on the grass at that point too, and John alluded to the fact that maybe he's picked up some splitter problems, but he did well to keep it out of that grass, out of the barrier, because I mean there was no runoff there at all. If it had got just a fraction slippy, considering how wet it was yesterday, can't be a lot of grip on the grass at the minute.
No, you're right. I mean, that is the thing I was thinking about, whether it could actually get off the grass once you get bogged in it, because there's so much rain there yesterday. But he did miss the 24 and he did miss the safety barrier, so he did a good job.
Now then, Juan Pablo Montoya, we were talking about him a moment ago, of course he caught one of David Reagan's pit crew, I think, while he was exiting. Of course, we were talking about the pit road wall being on the right here. The drivers are on the left of the car. He wouldn't have seen the David Reagan's man running round the back of the car there like that, and he just took the back of his leg away. I hope he didn't run him over with £3,500 worth of NASCAR.
Yeah, no, they're big old tanks, and them front splitters are very sharp. I mean, obviously they're carbon fibre, so when they do bottom the ground out there, they don't rub away the floor, and they've got sharp edges on. That's why a lot of the cars get punctures when they run tight together. And if he caught his ankle, then the man who got a tap would be in a bit of pain.
Well, we saw a shot of him a little bit earlier on. He obviously looked in some discomfort, but not screaming in pain, so that'll be some benefit, I suppose, to viewers. There's the weather, courtesy of Marcus Ambrose, giving us a great picture behind the Camry hybrid. And I'm slightly shocked that he's obviously on a schedule not to pit. He's sticking with his pit window, Marcus Ambrose. Him and his crew have decided to really go for it and not change from their strategy, Tim.
Yeah, it seems odd though, because I think most would consider that they were the race favourites and they had probably the, if not the most competitive package, then certainly one of them. Why go out on a limb? Why not follow the rest of the crowd and let your superior racecraft and car make the difference, not your strategy? It seems a slightly unnecessary risk.
Certainly does, and judging by the way they're all on and off the throttle and on the brakes, trying to keep some heat in those tyres at the moment. You saw Marcus Ambrose, we're looking back for him now, we're looking forward from him, and Kurt Busch to our left, that's obviously trying to get some heat in those front tyres as well. We must be close to coming under green. Lights are out on the Camry at the moment. He's going to go diving down there. We're about to come under green now. So as we head down the front straight, it is Marcus Ambrose, the Australian, that has control. He's not been in the pits, remember. Let's get back the track for the green flag.
Green flag waving here at the Heluva Good at the Glen, and Marcus Ambrose in the double foul restart trying to hold off the outside challenge from Kurt Busch. Remember, Kurt made that pass on the opening lap on Jimmy Johnson.
Good job by Ambrose to hold Kurt Busch off there. Looked like he had a nice run, but Ambrose stood hard in the gas and was able to stay out front.
Now the question is, Ambrose is the only car in the field that has not been on pit road. How long can he stay out there?
Yeah, that's the thing. He can stay out there for a few more laps. He's a little bit light on fuel, but he does not have as fresh a tires as Kurt Busch behind him here, but we'll see how that balances out.
I don't know if it's a question of how long he can stay out there, but how long will he stay out there?
Yeah, from this point, it doesn't really matter. He probably should make this pit stop because you know, if the caution comes out again, let's say right now, he'll have to make it under caution. He'll be back in 28th, actually probably in the mid-30s.
Let's listen to their radio.
It's great to fly early here, Frank, so don't panic if we didn't make the right choice there. We've got plenty of time. Hey, buddy. Not panicking yet. No. I hope you're not. No, we're good.
Kurt Busch trying to take the lead away with fresher tires in turn one, and makes it look easy. Almost.
Well, Kurt Busch got a great race car. He showed that from the beginning. And he looks like he's really good on fresh tires. After they ran 10 or 12 laps, he started losing a little bit of time, but he's making it up here with these fresh tires.
Yeah, he'd stretched it out far enough that losing a 10th or 2-3 in a lap, he had built up over a 2-second lead, so that wasn't a problem.
One of the road course specialists, Ron Fellows, had been on pit road a moment ago in the 0-9 car, and they're going to push that car back to the garage area. So troubles for Fellows. A five-time winner here at Watkins Glen and NASCAR's other divisions.
And Robbie Gordon is now one lap down after his problems on pit road. Actually, two laps down.
Let's update the 09. Jamie.
Well, the team's telling me that Ron Fellows' starter has broken. Remember, in the Nationwide Series, the one car, same team, they had an issue as well, and they lost quite a few laps. It's a bummer for the guy who's won here three times in the Nationwide Series, Doc.
And he finished fifth here in the Nationwide race on Saturday, but troubles here for Fellows today. The caution just a moment ago on lap 22 involved three cars, a spinning David Stremme. The two most heavily damaged cars were Stremme and Kevin Harvick. Let's find out what happened with Kevin Harvick and Jamie.
Well, perhaps the most severe damage was the 29. Kevin Harvick, you told me on Saturday how good this car was. What just happened?
It looked like the 12 just drove through the grass and just, I think, way over the means for how fast his car was. Obviously, he doesn't have the skill sets to continuously run the pace that he needs to run lap after lap and just drove through the grass there. So it's unfortunate for all guys on our Shell Pennzoil Chevy and just kind of got caught up in the wrong spot, wrong time. Kind of the story of the year, so wish it was over.
Severe damage on the left front. Kevin, any chance you'll get back out?
I hope not.
Kevin Harvick is out, guys.
Well, you can hear the frustration. Yeah, well, wow. Kevin Harvick out of it here at Watkins Glen.
Yeah, it looked like maybe Marcus Ambrose is going to be coming to the pits this time.
Watch and see if the two car is our leader. That is Kurt Busch.
All right, but nice and smooth right here. Nice and smooth.
Here comes a two-car of Kurt Busch down pit road.
Yeah, I don't quite understand this move.
I think they actually pitted way early for a reason. They thought everybody would come to pit road, and now they're in their window. Be the only thing I could think of. Guess we'll have to see how all this plays out, but 47 still on the racetrack, the only guy that hasn't been to pit road.
Let's go down today.
Hey guys, they were not going to take a chance on this being a two-stop race only for them. They could not have made it, and so they're going to take on fuel now. They'll have to make one more stop after this. No tires changed on this, just full of Sunoco fuel for Kurt Busch.
Almost stalls it, gets it fired, and tiptoes off of pit road at 35. So we'll see how that plays out for him. Marcus Ambrose, meanwhile, re-inherits the lead. And again, if you just joined our coverage, Marcus Ambrose has not pitted. We are at lap 29. He'll be finishing lap 30 this time by, and he has yet to come on pit road, although we are hearing that may happen this time by.
Well, if you absolutely don't have the range to do it, you can't do it. So these guys are just having to pit when they can and when they know they can make it. But, you know, the cars that can make it are going to have a huge advantage over these guys that are pitting now. And here comes Ambrose.
Let's go down to Vince.
Marcus Ambrose making his first stop of the day. Remember, 35 miles per hour on pit road. They're going to take four tires and fuel only. The only thing Marcos has really complained about is that he just doesn't feel like he's had as much grip that he would like. So they make a small air pressure adjustment, hoping that the fresh rubber and the air pressure adjustment will help. The strategy has been the big question mark for the 47 of Ambrose.
Now right here, got to be very careful, Dale.
Yeah, and this pit road goes downhill, so you really have to be careful and resist that temptation to get a little bit extra or even just the downhill taking your car. You have to be on top of it right here.
It was agonizingly slow to watch him go down pit road. One thing he'll have, though, is he'll have some clear racetrack, and he can make good laps. And if the caution comes out, then he can catch back up.
Yeah, that's the good thing about this strategy. You have nobody to contend with, so you can run some fast laps, and then as this whole thing cycles around, you've made faster laps than these guys that are back in there battling other cars.
With Kurt Busch and Marcus Ambrose now pitting, it is Jimmy Johnson now the leader again. Kyle Busch second, and guess who, guys? Superman at Watkins Glen, Tony Stewart.
Here he comes.
Is in third position.
Yeah, no surprise here. You know, Tony did... He didn't have the fastest car in practice, but he didn't need one in practice. He can use it right now.
I heard he was very comfortable with his race car, very happy with what he had, and felt like that at the end of practice time that he was ready to get himself up there and battle for a win.
Greg Biffle is fourth. Good run for Biffle. But look back in fifth spot here. Boris said having a great day here. He qualified in ninth position, very solid, and just slowly moving up.
This team. They put a lot of effort into this, and Boris looks, obviously, he's very excited about coming here, but team's showing a really good run here so far up in that fifth spot.
We talked about possibility of one of the road course experts possibly pulling off the upset. Look at the 13 car, Mad Max Pappas, driving for Germain Racing. Look where he started, and he's currently in the top 10, moving in eighth spot, trying to take seventh away.
He's had a solid car really all weekend long here, and now he's having a great race. Looking to the inside of McMurray, thinks better of it. But look right behind him, you got Clint Bowyer. He's running a good race also in the top 10.
And our biggest mover, and I think this is a great story, Matt Kenseth, who started at the back of the pack and has never had a top five finish on a road course in his career, Dave.
Well, Doc, you can put yourself in position by strategy, or you can do it by passing race cars. Now, Matt did not pass all those race cars on the track to do it, but his guys on pit road on that only pit stop got him seven positions. And during the David Stremme spin for our first caution, he went through the mess before the caution came out and picked up another six. So he's passed cars on the racetrack in several different ways, and that's how you put yourself back at least into contention.
Well, that's exactly what these guys needed to do their job. They do a great job on pit road week in and week out. And then Matt doing a solid job here on the racetrack. As these other guys pitted that last time, he was able to stay out there. Got himself up in 11th spot right now.
Okay, here you see Marcus Ambrose just making his first pit stop. Now, you're going to see a lot of the leaders are going to make their last pit stop here in the next six laps. They're going to make their last pit stop. And Ambrose is still going to have to do the same thing. I really believe he has put himself in a big hole right here that he's going to have a hard time digging out of.
What has to happen for him to maybe to climb back in this thing?
Well, what's going to have to happen is a lot of cars that made that stop at lap 19 are going to have to make more than one more stop. That's what's going to happen. You know, that is what will help him. If you have enough caution laps, though, from here to the end of the race, they will not have to make but one stop.
Now, what about this guy here, Kurt Busch? Now, he made that stop a lap before Ambrose. You see how far Ambrose is behind him.
Yeah, Kurt Busch made his stop just a little sooner than Ambrose, and also he did not take tires. He just got fuel.
That's right. That's the key, I think, that he had to take that time to put tires on, so gave him a little bit of an advantage there.
But Marcus Ambrose running 35th, but he's running good lap times, a 73.15 the last lap, which is virtually the same thing as Jimmy Johnson leading the race.
34 laps in the books, and right now the top three cars. Well, how about a four-time winner here at Watkins Glen? That would be Tony Stewart back in third position. And Smoke has been so good at this place, running second. Last year's winner, Kyle Busch. And the guy that's our leader, never won on a road course, the champ, Jimmy Johnson.
Plenty of intrigue in race strategy at Watkins Glen for teams trying to find the key to a perfect race. Who will be proved right in the Heluva Good at the Glen NASCAR Sprint Cup round? Kyle Busch leads from defending champion Jimmy Johnson and master of the Glen, Tony Stewart. Let's go back then to the track and pick up with our commentary team live.
Second spot, Jimmy Johnson and Tony Stewart. I'll show you how Kyle got by the 48 car.
It's going into turn 11 here. See, Jimmy's car still extremely loose for him. Kyle Busch able just to power up and had the preferred line as they head down into turn one.
Left side here. Still left side. Corner still up here.
And watch the 20 car, the rookie Joey Logano, right in front of Rudiman.
Yeah, that's just trying to make that pass but carrying more speed than your car can handle.
Lucky to have all that runoff area there so he didn't hit anything.
He got it fired and got headed back around, and then we have stayed green.
I want to correct one thing I said a while ago, that the leaders will make their pit stop. They're not going to make that pit stop for about 18 more laps. I thought I was looking at the wrong number on the monitor. Thought it was coming up sooner than it was.
Here's the pressure, Tony Stewart.
Too much pressure. I need to go ahead and let him go.
I think Jimmy's still struggling quite a bit with his car, as you see. Tony able to get pretty close. I don't know if he'll make a pass here. It looks like Jimmy might be in position to let him go. Nope, not ready to do that yet. I think Tony Stewart is in a position right now that he's just riding around this racetrack, biding his time. And as Andy said early on, he's going to be a guy to contend with when it comes time.
He's not going to show all his cards until it's time to put them on the table.
Now here's the two car of Kurt Busch. There's the interval. There's Kurt Busch. Remember, he came in and pitted on lap 29, and a lap later, Marcus Ambrose came in and pitted on lap 30. Now, there's Busch. You see Ambrose at the top of the screen just coming down the front straightaway. Now, when they pitted, or actually when Kurt Busch peeled off on lap 29, these cars were right together.
Yeah, but this is the difference in the two strategies. The two car pitted under that caution at lap 19, and then he took tires then. He comes down right here and only takes fuel, and it only takes a few seconds to top the thing off with fuel and get what they need. And then Ambrose comes around, and he has yet to make a pit stop, and he made a four-tire change under green, and now you see just how much difference that was on the track. Yeah, all the other times there are fairly close except for that crew time. You can see 5 seconds to put fuel in and 16.9 for four tires and fuel. And that total time on pit road is where it really shows up.
Marcus Ambrose has come back out running faster than Kurt Busch. Of course, he has the four tires now, but he's been able to cut down. He was a little over 11 seconds back of Kurt Busch. He's only 8 seconds back right now.
Let's update a couple other cars. We're told the 77 car of Sam Hornish is overheating, having an overheating issue. There is Sam on the racetrack after a car that was very good in practice early in the week. And the 26 car, Jamie McMurray, has gone to the garage area for a transmission problem. And let's see, he could have gotten a grill full here. That may be one of the overheating issues.
Yeah, it sure could. You get in that grass and it just stacks up right in that grill area. That's one of the negatives of this, you know, new car and that splitter, is that if you ever run off the racetrack, you're going to just pack it full.
Z has the leader on his bumper, and here Tony Stewart's taking over that second spot. Jamie?
Well, guys, Tony Stewart, he has come to life since his first pit stop. Remember, he started off pretty slow. He'd only gained one position because he was so loose. He came in and he acted as the crew chief. He told Darian Grubb exactly what he wanted in his car, and Darian even said, are you sure you want to put spring rubbers in and take that much time? Tony said, we have to. It was two spring rubbers. It was four tires. They made wedge adjustments on both sides. Guys, he has the grip. He has not said a word, and he has gone straight to the front.
Man, with his record here, I'd believe him too.
I would. I'd do anything he told me.
You don't doubt that, do you, Andy?
Whatever he said, that's what I would do. See, Sam Hornish now got some more problems. He's got Kyle Busch right on his bumper.
Sam trying to stay on the lead lap. He currently being shown in 34th position as the last car on the lead lap. Carl Edwards making a move inside of Elliott Sadler. And there, as you see, Juan Pablo Montoya right in front of him. That's 11th, 12th, and 13th on the racetrack.
See, Montoya there, he made a stop on the last caution to come in and get fuel to get themselves in their window.
Just got a quick shot of fuel. He didn't lose near as many spots as some of the other cars did on that stop, but he's made up some on the track, too. Shannon?
Well, exactly. He restarted 24th, and now he has moved his way up. He is looking at the top 10, guys. Brian Patty told me this weekend they've been very happy with this car. While some teams brought their Sonoma cars here this weekend, they brought a brand-new car. It was lighter for Juan Pablo Montoya, and it was just overall better. Right now, the handling is starting to go on this 42, but up until this point, they have only made one small air pressure adjustment as Juan Pablo Montoya looks to the inside and makes it around the 83 car. But Juan Pablo, happy with the car so far?
Well, it looks like he's handling pretty good right now. He's able to make these moves on at least these cars in this part of the running order.
Now, one of the cars, we had three cars that were caught speeding on the exit of pit road and started at the back of the longest line on the restart after they pitted on lap 19 was the 11 car, Denny Hamlin. There is the 11 of Hamlin, and he has worked his way all the way back up to 14th position.
Yeah, and Jeff Burton's right behind him in the 15th spot, but a nice run for them. The other one that had that penalty was Dale Jr., and he came back in the last time that we had a caution and topped his fuel off, so he should be ready to go for one more stop.
Yeah, Dale Jr. now being shown in 25th spot, but all those cars on the lead lap and being able to gain some ground here. Watch Hamlin try to make a move inside of Vickers.
Yeah, there's no doubt he has one of the fastest race cars on the track, Andy.
Yeah, he had the fastest car on the track before that first caution. He was running Kurt Busch down by a couple three-tenths a lap and then got nailed with that penalty.
Just don't know how much has changed their strategy. They've had some things that have a crash on the track.
Oh, hard, Junior. Hard lick for Junior.
And he is head first into the tire barrier. All the way across the gravel.
We're done.
Reed Sorensen involved in this wreck. Yeah, this is going to bring the caution out. Man, Junior, he stuffed that thing in the tires.
See if I can get out of here.
See the steering wheel coming off the 88.
He's got the wind in that down to show the safety crews that he is okay.
That car's not okay.
I lost the brakes.
Lost the brakes.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You can see right here.
And that's what got Sorensen in trouble.
Sorensen just a victim here.
And even all that sand and gravel can't slow a car down.
It slowed it down. That's the key thing.
That's right.
It still didn't keep it from hitting the wall, but definitely knocked a lot of speed off here. This could have been a really bad crash for Dale Jr. had it not been for this area. This is what NASCAR and Watkins Glen have done to make it safer.
Just got taken out, guys. Just got taken out by the 88.
Yeah, well, it wasn't intentional. He just didn't have any way of slowing his car down. Reed Sorensen, wrong spot at the wrong time.
That's Keith Barnwell, the spotter for the 43, and all he saw was 88 dive inside, and all of a sudden they're crashed. He didn't know why.
And Dale Jr. just hustled that car back up into 24th position after being on pit road. And, wow, just no brakes. And, DJ, I mean, there's not much more you can do, I mean, with regard to coming in there at that speed.
Well, it's just, you try to make a
terribly bad
situation as good as you possibly can. As you can see, Reed Sorensen here, he's rolling. He's trying to drive around this gravel pit, get himself back on the racetrack. He's going to be able to do that now as he goes through the mud.
See Junior trying to run over there and tell him maybe didn't mean to, guy, just ran out of brakes.
Under caution now for the third time today here at Watkins Glen.
A dejected Dale Jr., and we're yet to find out just what the problem was with his brakes there, but clearly, John Mickle, he had none as he came under Reed Sorensen, and Reed Sorensen, we've got to say sorry for him.
Yeah, see, funny, see a little bit of smoke on his left front wheel. It almost seemed like some of the brakes didn't work, but he was definitely carrying a lot of speed, and then he couldn't slow the car down, and poor old Reed Sorensen got the worst of it, but I was glad to see him come out.
Tim, got to say that a lot of speed going into this corner, of course, but these are big, heavy cars. We've mentioned it earlier. And even with what is a fairly big gravel trap by Watkins Glen standards, still didn't stop these two cars before they got right to the edge.
No, I mean, obviously, you know, momentum slowed, but that was still a fairly sizable impact that Earnhardt had going straight in head on and got, you know, certainly a few feet into the tyre wall.
We're looking at Marcus Ambrose there, of course, and I'm still yet to try and work out his strategy. I've got to say that road course strategy is something that that I certainly struggle with, and I'm sure many at home do as well, John. So maybe you'll enlighten us a little bit on what's been going on here at the moment, because Marcus Ambrose and his crew definitely have stuck with what seemed like a pre-race strategy, whereas others have reacted to the atmosphere and what's going on around them.
Yeah, it's all down to fuel. Helmin, on a normal oval, it's usually run a tank of gas out, come in, top it up and go again. Road courses, they work backwards, just for track position. So you want to come in early, get out early, so when the other cars pit after you, they cycle around the track after you. So Marcus must be thinking, I don't know what he's thinking, to be fair, because I still think they've got to do two pit stops, and I still think he's going to fall out of sync and go to the back of the line. I think he's made a wrong decision, because I think everybody else, like the two car, has got only two stops as well, and I still think he'll cycle in front of him. But we can be proved wrong.
Tim, I mean, road course racing, it's you either love it or you hate it, it would seem, if you're a NASCAR fan. But certainly it gives us a completely different scenario to work with and to look at.
It does, and as you say, it's a completely different discipline, not just for the fans, and it's a nice variety, but also for the crews. And as John's saying, I mean, I think, you know, the 47 team have maybe got their call wrong, and maybe some of these teams, you know, they're not quite as adept at the road course strategy as others, and sometimes the bigger, more famous teams, such as Penske, you know, you think with Kurt Busch in the number two, you think, well, they're going to be more likely to get it right. And certainly at the moment, they seem to have done, because they've got track position on Marcus Ambrose and they need one less pit stop.
Well, we're on our third caution period, full course caution of the day. On lap 42, it was Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the barrier with Reed Sorensen. Let's go back to the track now.
NASCAR Sprint Cup racing here at historic Watkins Glen International on a sunny Monday afternoon. Under caution for the third time a day, heavy contact, a couple of cars off the racetrack. Strategy beginning early here, lap 19, and Marcus Ambrose decides to stay on the racetrack and play the fuel game. Was it a smart move? It remains to be seen. Race for the chase, been a tough year for Richard Childress Racing, and David Stremme spins in the inner loop. A couple of cars almost got by, but Kevin Harvick, one of the hard luck drivers of the year involved, his day is over. Kyle Busch trying to take the lead, the first laps he has led since Daytona in July, and Kyle became the fifth different leader with the seventh lead change of the afternoon. And the most recent caution, no brakes for the 88 car, nudges the 43, and Dale Jr. goes head-on into the tire barrier. Fortunately, he's gotten out and is okay. Now, while we were under caution a moment ago, the 47 car here, Marcus Ambrose, deciding now to come on the pit road.
Didn't have anything to lose. He was already at the back of the lead lap cars, so he came down and got some tires. You know, I guess the thought is here, he'll get some fresher rubber. He's going to have to pass a lot of cars, I can tell you that.
But there were other cars that came down pit road that he could have passed and not had to pass them once we go back. So, I don't know, strange strategy going on there.
Well, the thinking was is there weren't many cars behind him on the lead lap, and they thought tires would help him make some of these passes.
Let's find out exactly what they're thinking down there in Marcus Ambrose pits as we talk to Marcus.
Hey Marcus, Dale Jarrett, the ESPN, you happy?
Hey, great, Dale.
Well, how's your day going so far?
Oh, just looking at a position, not too good. Got a really fast car, it just hasn't really gone our way with strategy here. We'll see what happens now. We've got some tires, got some fuel. Worst case scenario, we just have to get a splash at the end when other guys hit the pit.
So you think pretty much these are the four tires you're going to finish the race on?
Yeah, gentle.
You're able. It looks like you might be one of the few cars and drivers that are able to make some passes out there.
Now, I'm not sure why it's so difficult today, but it really is difficult to make a pass. I get close to anyone and I start flying the nose. And my forward driver's been just marginal all day anyway, so it's an issue, but I think I can make a few passes here, especially the back, and see what we can do.
All right, Marcus, thanks for talking with us. Good luck.
Yeah, thank you.
Marcus coming in lap 44, so 47 laps to go here at Watkins Glen. 90 laps makes up this 200-mile race. Kyle Busch is the leader. Tony Stewart in second. Jimmy Johnson third. Biffle, and in fifth spot is the 08 car of Boris Sett. Let's listen to his radio.
Hey, well, you got to let us know this next run whether you think that it was is still continuing to get better or not. That's going to play a big decision on that last run for us and what we do on pressures.
Seems like it's starting to get a little better, but it's definitely a lot freer.
They're under caution, and they're going to get set to line up for the restart here at Watkins Glen. We'll remind you, coming up following our race today will be NASCAR Now on ESPN2. And, of course, NASCAR Nationwide Series racing coming your way. The Carfax 250 at Michigan next Saturday, 3 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN2. And next Sunday at 1 o'clock on ESPN, the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series Carfax 400 at Michigan International Speedway. So they're going to line them up, and we're going to take a quick break and come back with the restart here halfway home at Watkins Glen.
We asked the question when we came on air, and Kyle Busch so far has an answer. He's aiming to make the chase come September, and a good drive today will see him leap back into contention.
Our current top three in points, you see Tony Stewart. He is our points leader, actually running second in the race, and Jimmy Johnson is second in the points. And then Jeff Gordon coming in now 260 behind officially. And the top speed now, fastest speed, 176 miles an hour. That was the Kyle Busch clocking right at the end of the backstretch prior to going into the bus stop.
That's hauling in the heat.
For more NASCAR stats, in-car audio, and live race radio, check out NASCAR Sprint Cup Mobile at sprint.com/speed. Let's listen into the radio of our current points leader, Tony Stewart.
I think this is going to buy us enough caution laps here that we can make it what we need to do for a window to the end. Kind of comical, all riding around there silent.
We're all trying to do what we can for the environment.
Able to have some fun there. A double file restart. Tony Stewart on the outside. Kyle Busch, a leader, former teammates. And Jimmy Johnson third, Biffle fourth, Boris Sett fifth. And by the way, Carl Edwards has started 33rd all the way up in 12th position. So Carl, cousin Carl, is coming. So is Juan Pablo Montoya.
Yeah, he's in there. But I looked at Boris Sett and Max Pappas, both up in the top 10.
And they are nose to tail there coming out of turn one, talking about the 08 and 13 cars.
How about Stewart still on the outside of Kyle Busch? takes the lead.
That's a power move right there.
Yes, sir.
We've always said that's where Tony Stewart's the best, up through the S's.
Kyle Busch is the one that showed everybody that move on Saturday.
He's fighting back. He's going to try to make a move here. Tony's protecting the inside. Not going to be much room for Kyle right there this time, Bob.
Tony has not led a lap today. He'll have to get back to the start-finish line for it to be official. Now double foul in the bus stop. There comes Marcus Ambrose back in the pack trying to make a move.
Jeff Gordon has moved back into the top 20 after that hard lick he took up there in the bus stop on that one caution with David Strimme.
Yeah, Marcus Ambrose has those four tires back there. He's going to try to make as many spots as he can while he has that fresh rubber.
These double foul restarts really work into the advantage of some of the cars that get caught in the back, and our faster cars can try to make a move. Marcus Ambrose car right up under the back of Scott Speed in traffic. Side by side, Martin Truex and Clint Bowyer in turn one.
Yeah, that's close racing. Right behind them also, Montoya.
Montoya trying to make the move on the outside on Casey Mears in turn two, and he does it. Little contact.
And Casey trying to hold off now Carl Edwards. As you look back at Carl, he will fall in line behind Mears.
See right behind here, Borsett. He's trying to block Max Pappas, who's having a great run.
Yeah, every time we see Max Pappas in his 13, he's up behind somebody. Somebody holding him up. So he's got a fast car today. Vince?
That Borsett car has been fast off the truck this weekend, guys. They've not made many changes at all. Same car as they had at Sonoma, and it was good there, but they bounced off a few things, so they didn't have a good result. They've been really good today. The one thing Boris has said hasn't really been about the car. He just says, it's hot in here. I'm really thirsty. When we pit, can I have two bottles of ice-cold water?
Just simple request. What great racing here. We told you that there were seven so-called road course ringers in the field today. A lot of discussion in the garage here that maybe someone could pull off a huge upset. Well, the previous caution flag came out because of a hard impact between the 43 and 88, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. head-on into the wall. Let's visit with him. Shannon.
Well, it's good to see Dale Earnhardt Jr. released from the infield care center. Better yet, a smile on your face. We heard you say brakes. What happened to the car out there?
Going into three, I mashed the brake, and it worked for a split second. Then it went to the floor like it blew a hose brake line or something. So I tried to miss the 43 and couldn't do a good job at that, but wasn't much I could do. I couldn't slow my car down. And the Honda device and all the gravel traps slowed the car down a little bit, and the tire barrier worked great. And hopefully, the car's not too bad, but just real bad luck. We had some real bad luck.
Dale, we know that this is a heavy braking track. Did you guys have any brake problems during practices this session this weekend?
Well, I didn't have any problems with Damp Energy Chevrolet all weekend. The last couple laps I was fading, the brakes were fading. So I let the 71 and 98 pass, and then they broke, so something's going on with them.
All right, good to see Dale Earnhardt Jr. released from the infield care center. Guys?
Indeed, hard lick, and good to see that he is indeed okay. Up front, Tony Stewart, Kyle Busch, Jimmy Johnson, Greg Biffle, and Max Pappas, and there comes Carl Edwards looking again. By the way, Pappas has gotten by Boris Said for fifth position. Martin Truex is an unheralded road racer. He's doing a heck of a job. Dave.
He's driving it like Harold, isn't he? He is doing very well right now, and he is one of the guys that is on what you call maybe the normal pit stop strategy today. He was on pit road on lap 19. The difference for him today is that crew chief Kevin Mannion told me this morning, we can afford to be overly aggressive on our fuel strategy at the end. So look for them possibly to short pit. They haven't talked about it yet, but possibly short pit and gamble near the end. But Andy, would you do that when your car's running this well with the leaders?
Yeah, that's a hard thing to do. It's easy to make those aggressive strategy calls when you're kind of out of the top 10 to try to get up there. But when you're there, you don't want to take yourself out of a chance to try to win it the conventional way, let's call it.
I think they're within about three laps of starting to see some guys start to gamble. As we see, Borsted's having some problems here.
Yeah, we see this 08 throwing water out of the overflow. Now he's on pit road.
Clean the grill, good. You got to get it clean.
Yep, they're going to go ahead and make this stop now and try to get this grill clean. That's what happens around this place. You get the pick up debris. Vince?
Well, you see the water spewing out of the right front of the car. That's the sign it's overheating. And we told you earlier that Boris was talking about himself overheating, needing the cold water. And then the car really started showing the effects of it. They're going to take the time and change all four tires, as well as cleaning off the front of that grill to try to help it out in the temperature.
Good. Let's go.
A lot of fluid out of that radiator and that cooling system. Be surprised if they don't have to come back in and put water in that car.
So we can see what clogged up that front of the 08 car. Sometimes you get off the course, but there's grass.
You ran off just a little bit right there. And again, right here, this could have done it right there. That did clog that grill up. Well, it doesn't take much. So you can see that even the splitter brace is broken in the center.
Morris Head comes on pit road running in sixth position, and now has made a pit stop and try to clean that off. Here are the guys. Everybody's chasing Tony Stewart, Kyle Busch, Jimmy Johnson.
I'm going to say Tony Stewart needs to be careful, too. He just got a piece of the grass coming off of 11.
What about some of the biggest movers and fastest cars on the race course? You just saw the two of Kurt Busch go by up 11 positions. Here comes Marcus Ambrose. And he's making another pass. So Ambrose up to 22nd position. Those guys are on the move. And the guys they are chasing right now up front, no surprise. Jimmy Johnson still trying to get his first road course victory ever. Kyle Busch running second, who won here a year ago. And the man at Watkins Glen, Tony Stewart.
We're on lap 51 of the 90 at Watkins Glen International then. Clear skies all around, but a few people that have been worrying about the weather back at home. Regards Nathan Older from Mason in Kent. He said, how far into the race do they need to go if it rains to be able to call it a full race? That'll be half distance then, John.
It'll be half distance. Once they get to the halfway, they can claim it a race if they can't get the other laps in.
Nathan goes on and says also, what would have happened if it rained again today? Delayed till Tuesday?
It is delayed another day. There obviously is a cut-off time where they have to say enough's enough because they've got to get to Michigan next week. And I think they give it one more chance.
A lot of people betting on Marcus Ambrose today, Tim, and a lot of people are going to be disappointed, it looks like.
Yeah, I mean, he finally had to come in for this for his second stop under green. He's making progress, but not half as much as Kurt Busch, actually. So he and Busch, when they went green last on lap 44, they were just one car between them, and now Busch is all the way up to 13th. So that's 15 places in 7 laps. We've got to watch out for Kurt Busch.
Marcus Ambrose has just made a pass on Casey Kane. Getting back to some of the emails here, I have a question regarding lug nuts. It's one of your favourites, John, so we'll go on with that. How are the lug nuts attached to the new rims when they do the tyre change? In Formula 1, they have one central locking nut that stays in the wheel gun when they change, but not sure how they deal with the 5 or 6 lug nuts during tyre changes. That's from Sean Cunningham in Hertfordshire.
How that works is called Gorilla Glue, they call it. It's a bit like an Evo stick, that sort of type of glue. It's elasticated. The people that go over the wall do them about hour to hour and a half before each race. They put it around the lug nut, stick it on and put a weight on the wheel. And then they have to get it just right so the elasticity is when they put the wheel on, it stretches so it stays on the lug nut. But that's how it's held on.
An overwhelming amount of people enjoying the Monday night coverage of NASCAR. We are pleased to have you with us. Overwhelming number of newcomers as well that are writing into us. Very pleased to have your company tonight. Do keep looking in regularly to NASCAR and, of course, IndyCar if that's your bent as well. Now then, let's take a look. Jeff Reese from the Ronda, we've heard from him a little earlier, I think, as well. How many of the oval tracks also have road courses? He's a bit of a road course fan. I know Indianapolis does from the Formula One days. Could this be used as it tends to be one of the less exciting oval races? Alternative, what about Pocono or Fontana? Well, certainly Indianapolis could have done with a bit more of a sparkly race this year. Maybe the road course would have been the answer, Tim.
Yeah, indeed. The answer is a lot of the ovals do have a road course set up. One of the reasons a track owner wouldn't want to do it is because they would feel that they can't fill all the grandstands all the way round. So there's a sort of economic reason to it. The other thing is you've got to remember that NASCAR are always inherently oval racing and they're not going to support too many road races. In fact, these two road races we have are kind of a concession to the fans.
Well, Jeff Reese from the Ronda, of course, is the man that he's into a bit of betting, Jeff Reese, and he usually gets it about right. So we look forward to more emails from you, preferably before the races start, though, Jeff, if you don't mind, because you've obviously made a bob or two. We've been following your progress. Thanks very much. Well, as you can see, the racing continues under a fantastic day. I mean, pretty unbelievable that there's such a change in weather, but that's this particular area for you. Let's go back to the track then. We're on lap 54.
Well, our leader is Tony Stewart, so why don't we let radio check. Whoops. Got a crash on the racetrack, the 39 car of Ryan Newman going around. Contact with Patrick Carpentier.
And we said that's the action spot on this course.
Clear after the 09, all clear.
Guys have been racing hard and fighting for some territory. Still green on the racetrack.
So we will stay green and we will try to get you up to speed here. We go back up front. Tony Stewart is our leader. We'll let Radio Shack get you up to speed with the top 10, starting with Jamie Little.
Well, Doc, I talked to Darian Grubb, crew chief for Tony Stewart, about fuel mileage, and he said, we're not good. Why? Because in order to get good fuel mileage, you have to cut back on power. Tony didn't want to sacrifice the power, so it's helped him to get to the front. Now he's telling his driver, short shift in order to save that fuel, and right now they think they're good. Dave?
Well, Kyle Busch got passed by Tony Stewart on that restart, and listened to his radio about that kind of thing.
This guy is stewed, officer.
Jimmy Johnson spun off in turn one.
And Johnson gets it underway.
Up around a pit this time. Up around a pit this
got
time.
Got a lot of cars on pit road this lap also.
Jimmy Johnson's pit, you see they're going to bring him in. Pit road very busy all of a sudden, guys. Here, let's go down to Jamie, the 99 pit.
Well, Carl Edwards told his crew chief, I'm a bit tight in the corners. He said, keep wheeling it. Air pressure adjustment, four tires and fuel for the 99. Dave?
The 11 car is on pit road. Chassis adjustment for Denny Hamlin. The 1 car is on pit road. 17 of Matt Kenseth has been waved down pit road. Don't see him quite yet. This is the stop, guys. 07 Casey Mears on pit road as well. They're all getting tires and fuel for the last time.
So the fuel went open up, Andy, just like you predicted and calculated, and everyone came in the first chance they had. And here's the 43 off of pit road.
Might.
To the garage. Take it to the garage. Take it to the garage. Just go to the garage, guys. Take it to the garage.
That's going to be close. He may not get out of here, boys. This might bring out a caution. Whoop, here he's moving. Now he stopped messing. This is a good break for these cars. They made it on pit road.
Kyle Busch in. And here's the 13 car. Max Pappas in, and the fourth place car of Greg Bevel. There's Pappas.
Well, if they get a caution right now, these other guys are going to be sitting in some really good positions that have been on the pit road. Vince?
There's Max Pappas finishing up his pit stop, and Greg Biffle is in as well. As you noted, a great run for Biffle today. Four tires and a quarter round down in the right rear, Dave.
Kyle Busch did a slide into his pit box, but he didn't go over the line, so the pit crew is still able to do the work on that 18 car. He still needs a little bit of a fix, just a little bit tight. Jimmy Johnson is in as well. He will get four tires and fuel, still a little bit loose. Chassis adjustment for him, and now Kenseth makes his stop on pit road. Four tires and fuel for Matt Kenseth. Lap 55, the lap of choice for all of these leaders, guys.
And Mark Martin coming into his pit box as well. He's down and away already. It was four tires, Sunoco fuel for Mark Martin.
Final pit stop for these guys. You see Mark Martin, the last one of those coming off pit road. Ryan Newman still sitting in the pits. Tony Stewart, here he comes in for what should be his final stop.
Well, he was hung out to dry if that caution came out, but Breed Sorensen was able to get
four
out of that gravel.
Four tires.
And not bring out the caution. It was a real break for this 14 team. Now they're going to be able to make their stop and have one extra lap of fuel.
Jamie?
Darian Grubb saying normal procedure, four tires and fuel. Hey, that car was so good last stint. Why make a change? Guys?
Tony in and not far in front of him. Juan Pablo Montoya also in the pits there. So these guys able to work the strategy. Shannon.
Guys, the cars come around for Juan Pablo Montoya. No changes. Four tires and fuel for the 42 car. They're making their way through the field to the front. Guys?
What a big break for Tony Stewart and Montoya that the caution did not come out.
Yeah, it was a big break. But did you see just how much slower these pit stops are on a road course than we typically see on an oval? I mean, up in the 17-second bracket.
You can see Tony Stewart's crew have a lot of trouble around on the left side. Here now is our leader, Kurt Busch, back to the front.
Yeah, but he has to make one more stop. And he needs to go ahead and make that stop right now before he gets caught out there with another caution.
Running in second spot is A.J. Allmendinger in the 44 car. There he comes. There comes A.J. Had a good run here last year driving the Red Bull car. Ran in the top 10 for much of the afternoon, and here comes Allmendinger down for his what should be his final stop.
Four tires, half down track bar. Four tires, half down track bar. Pack it with fuel.
See Allmendinger's fuel window just a little shorter than some of the other cars. But it's not going to hurt them. Like I say, if the caution had come out here just like a couple laps ago, it would have really hung out a lot of cars. This would have been one of them. But now that the caution has not come out, they should be fine from this point.
Yeah, the one thing that I look at here is these start to cycle out. Kyle Busch is in the fourth spot right now. Marcus Ambrose is behind Kyle Busch and Tony Stewart, and he still has to get to pit road. So he's pretty much given up any chance he's going to have at this thing today.
If he's going to win or have a chance to win, he's going to have to pass a lot of cars on the track.
Kurt Busch is the leader now. He did come back in on lap 29, so he's got the fuel to go a few more laps after he jettisons a water bottle. The question is, how long does he wait?
Well, I think he's got some clean racetrack here right now. He can make some pretty good laps, and that might be the top thing on their agenda.
Here they're coming this time.
Yeah, I think they thought better of that strategy, because the longer you stay out there, the worse shape you're going to be if that caution comes out.
Leader on pit road here with 33 laps to go. Kurt Busch has led 100 laps in his career on a road course, but has yet to win in cup racing on a road course. It's hard to believe as good as he has been. Now, he is coming down pit road at 35 miles an hour, and
We know he's only going to get gas. That's what they said. No, they're going to get tires. It's actually Ambrose that's going to get fuel. You see, the two car is down in front of you, Dave.
Here's what to watch for, Andy. He was running in about 13th position before the round of pit stops. He was running behind Casey Mears, Denny Hamlin, and Matt Kenseth before they pitted. So let's see if this strategy helps him pick up some positions on pit road. It's a good stop. He's out of here now. Let's see where Kurt shakes out. Mears and Hamlin do go by.
As you said, Dave, that was a good stop in comparison to a lot of the other ones that we've seen. These guys kept it down in the 15-second bracket.
Now, Marcus Ambrose, when he makes his stop, he said that he had the tires on his car he was going to finish the race on, so they're just going to get fuel. So we'll see how that closes the gap maybe on Ambrose and Kurt Busch.
The cycle of pit stops now. There is Marcus Ambrose in the 47 car, so he has plenty of laps before he will need to come in.
Well, he does. He's got a lot of laps before he has to pit, but he really needs to make that stop now, because if he doesn't and the caution comes out, he's going to be in the same boat he was earlier, having to go all the way back to the end of the lead lap cars. He needs to pit right now if he can make it to the end, which he should be able to do. It's only 32 laps to go right now. Even though he does have a lot of fuel in the tank, it's still not helping him at all. This would be a good time to duck right here.
And they're not going to do it. They're going to stay out.
Well, their strategy's been a little confusing from the beginning, so it continues to be that.
Up front, David Stremme and Scott Speed also need to make one more stop. So they have yet to come on pit road.
Yeah, David Stremme up in the lead. We saw him just a little while ago involved in an accident over in the bus stop, missing part of the right front fender of his car, but is able to be up front right now.
See the risk that Ambrose is taking right now. Somebody gets caught in the gravel trap or something right here, gets in a spin, brings a full course yellow. He's going to have to pit.
Yeah, and that was an important pass for Robbie Gordon. He was two laps behind. He got himself one lap down, and if the caution would happen to come out, he would be in a good position then.
Four tires and fuel.
Streamy's coming in this time.
Up on the track bar, one round, Trent. One round up on the track bar. Watch your speed coming in.
See, getting down to 35 miles an hour is really slow. They got one of the first boxes. Need a good stop here, Vince.
That's right, the 12, and you see it on the right front of that car. They had some wheel well damage from earlier right there. It was a great look at it, so that's been an effective hit stops for them throughout the course of the day to make sure that gets cleaned up. They've done that, and a good clean stop for the 12 and away, trying to salvage their day.
Even with a damaged race car, David Stremme having a good job on the racetrack. Here's the 82 car, Scott Speed, who did not qualify at Infineon when he wanted to run on the road course out there, did qualify for his first trip to Watkins Glen in a stock car, and is being shown as the leader, but he will have to make a trip on the pit road here for the final stop. Less than 30 laps to go here at Watkins Glen International. Scott Speed is the leader. He'll have to come on pit road, and when the cycle is complete, Kyle Busch will reassume the lead.
He's out.
All of these guys are out of the car. That's a good thing. See, we saw Jeff Burton on the other side of the guardrail.
I'll show you what happened here a moment ago on lap 61.
Here's Sam Hornish racing with Casey Kane as they come out of the corner.
Oh, looks like Casey got loose and tried to correct it. Got into Sam, and goodness gracious, what
just
a
lick. Just as we saw the other thing. Wow, huge lick by Jeff Gordon. It's good to see him get out of his car.
And Sam Hornish. Both of those cars hit extremely hard on that second impact.
Gordon head on into the Armco barrier.
We saw this happen with Jason Leffler's car the other day, get thrown back, and Jeff Gordon wide open, nowhere to go.
It's good to see those guys get out of the car.
Joey Logano just missing the inside of the 77 car when he came by.
Right along with Jeff Gordon here. Be ready, folks. This is hard. Ooh. Man, just no time to do anything.
And there's no safer barrier there. That's just an Armco barrier, steel barrier. Fortunately, Jeff able to get the helmet off and walk away. Hard, hard lick here.
Yeah, tough day for Jeff.
Here are the drivers now involved in the crash. Jeff Gordon, Sam Hornish, Jeff Burton, the three primary ones. Andy Lally got some damage. Casey Kane was slid off the track and initiated that when the car got loose. And Joey Logano got some sheet metal damage trying to get by the inside of Sam Hornish. Now let's update the pit stop strategy here. We were talking about Marcus Ambrose and when he might have come in, but he actually did come down pit road on lap 55.
Yeah, he snuck in there. Dale and I missed it. He came in under green, made his stop with 55 to go, which is exactly what he needed to do, and he only took on fuel. That's why he was in and out really quick. He's put himself now in the top five and not having to make another pit stop, so he is in a great position now to get a good finish. The only car that's on the track that has to make another stop is Scott Speed. He's going to be shown as the leader, but he'll have to make one more stop.
Yeah, and I apologize to those guys for questioning their strategy. They're on top of it. Got lost in the race there for a minute, so they've got a chance to win this race today.
We are under caution for the fourth time a day here at the Hell of a Good at the Glen. A heavy crash out of Turn 9. Back in a moment.
I know that hell of a good. It's certainly a hell of a big crash. And really, on lap 62, then our fourth caution came out. Jeff Gordon, Sam Hornish, and Jeff Burton in amongst it. And proving to us once again how tough the car of tomorrow is. I mean, we saw a horrendous accident towards the end of this race last year. And in this occasion today, John Mickle and Tim Scott here with me in the studio. I mean, both of you were flinching at the sight of that. And at the point we saw it, we were on the brake. Didn't really know whether anyone would be walking away from that. To see Jeff Gordon walk away from it, we can see it again. And really, ladies and gentlemen, you can come out from behind the sofa right now because it's one of those kind of crashes. Casey Kane up the inside of Sam Hornish. Put Sam Hornish in there. I don't quite know what happened there at all, but watch the speed pick up when he goes into the tyres, straight into Jeff Gordon, who then goes straight into the barrier on the opposite side of the track. And somehow Jeff Burton gets involved in it as well. A lot of drivers being pretty lucky to avoid the debris, but watch this from this angle. John, your thoughts?
Casey Kane just got loose, and the 9 was just his another set of four tyres to stop the 9 going off. Sam Hornish, he got involved in the big crash last year, at the end of pit wall, if you'll remember. And poor Jeff Gordon here, good job he's got a hands device on, otherwise I dread to think what happened. But that is a hard hit.
I mean, to put our cameras out, I've got to say they're fairly resilient things, but look at the size of that. That is an ugly set of scenes, and really takes your breath away, Tim, when you see something like that. I mean, that's a big crash by any formula standards. I mean, the car of tomorrow was brought in effectively to enhance safety, and I think time and again we've seen that it does.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, they've got proper impact structures, you know, crumple areas in the front of the car inbuilt, to absorb some of that impact on a front on. I mean, that was a, I'd like to know what the G reading was of that was, because on Jeff Gordon going straight into the barriers, because that was a really hard hit. And that's one of the things about Watkins Glen. I mean, it's a great track, but you know, it's not the most modern of circuits, and there is very, very little runoff area. The barriers, they're in a bit of a chute there, and the barriers are right there. And when you get that kind of incident, you hit another car, go off sideways, you are straight into the barrier.
Well, that was the Robbie Gordon, Joey Logano corner as well from yesterday's Nationwide corner. They had a bit of a coming together in there. Time then to go back to the track, because I'm sure our reporters are going to be running around with gusto.
A massive cleanup project underway there on the back straightaway here again on lap 63. Six cars involved in what was a grinding crash. Now watch Casey Kane's car get loose and come into the side of Sam Hornish.
Yes, they exit turn nine here. Watch Casey's car back in, step out right there. He has to correct, gets into the right front of Sam Hornish, sends him into the tire barrier right here, and that launches him right back in front of Jeff Gordon. Huge impact. And then he gets hit by Jeff, or Sam Hornish gets hit by Jeff Burton again. That's just as violent a crash as you're going to see on a road course. Wow.
Man. So 31 car come around. Look at Logano. He bounces off the inside barrier.
It knocked the fuel cell out of Sam Hornish's car, Andy.
Yeah, he hit here with the front end. It just launches this car up in the air. Jeff Gordon is completely blindsided here. Nowhere to go, and he hits
look
hard. Now watch this. Oh, my goodness. Yeah, you can see the fuel cell and the whole rear clip right here coming off of Sam Hornish's car.
Wow. You know, we've said a lot of things about these cars, but we can't say enough about the safety aspect of them.
You see a lot of those parts flying, even the rear clip, frame section. None of that hurts the driver. The driver's compartment is the strongest part of this vehicle, and losing these parts is really not a bad thing as far as the driver inside that car. You just don't want those things flying around hitting somebody else, but... good to see that the driver's compartment stayed intact and everybody's okay.
There were six cars involved. Those three were the most heavily damaged. Andy Lally still on the racetrack. Joey Logano, as is Casey Kane in the nine car. Let's listen in.
Dang it, I got loose and just shot him off track with the back of my car. That was my fault. Sorry about that, Sam. Yeah, I'm fine. I don't think he knew I was under him because I was up, and then he came shooting back down on the left side of me, and then he kind of turned away, and I just got loose, spun into him sideways kind of.
Yeah, that's what it looked like. It didn't look like anything intentional by no means, but it still caused a...
No, and there's nothing. Yeah, there's nothing Casey Kane can do. He has to correct his car, so just unfortunate.
Well, we mentioned that the Marcus Ambrose has pitted, is in fourth position, in position possibly to win this thing. Let's talk to his crew chief, Vince.
Well, the 47 team's had a thirsty driver and a thirsty race car. The driver wants some water, and the race car's been chewing up the, drinking up the fuel. Frankie, you haven't had the fuel mileage you'd hoped maybe today, but do you have enough fuel now to get to the end of the race?
We're still a lap or two short. Well, these cautions are going to help. But we were stuck in the window we had with the mileage we were getting. You know, we could have stopped with them other guys. You know, the two car had to stop later, too, you know, so... It was either splash like he did. Now he's back in like 14th, and you know we're in fourth. So we had to stay out there and do what we had to do with the mileage we were getting.
You're not, of course, using fuel now as it's under a red flag situation. But once we do get going, what's the conservation situation that you're going to be in with your driver?
Well, every caution, we're going to save as much as we can. Pretty much coast around three quarters of the racetrack with the motor off, and. Just pray we got enough. I mean, they got a full, and catch a couple cautions or maybe one more, we'll be okay.
Well, these guys, tough decisions to make up here on the box, guys, trying to make the proper calls and the right fuel strategy here at Watkins Glen.
Thanks, Vince. We were talking about how hot and humid it is today, the rains yesterday, and a lot hotter than it's been. And you can see the drivers not only trying to drink water, trying to pour some water in that suit. DJ, you've been there. You know that it can be steamy in these cars.
Yeah, you really hate red flag conditions after you've been out there for this long. You're sweating, it's hot, and this heat doesn't go out of the car. You're doing whatever you can to keep yourself a little bit on the cool side. You see him pouring some water, cold water on a rag, and trying to get it on his neck and his... the back of his neck, so it's just a difficult situation as you sit there.
You talk about road course racing, and you don't think you can wreck big time like you can on an oval at Daytona or a Talladega. Folks, guess again, because it can happen in a hurry. Coming out of turn nine, here's what happened again. The contact, Casey Kane into the side of Sam Hornish, into the tire barriers, across to Jeff Gordon, head on into the wall. The back of Hornish's car sheared away. Jeff Burton involved, and three other cars getting minor damage. So fortunate that all three of these drivers able to walk away from what was a violent impact, bringing out the caution for the fourth time today here at Watkins Glen.
Once again at Watkins Glen, we see a huge wreck. The cars involved were destroyed, but the drivers were all okay. The fourth full course caution of the day has turned into a red flag condition as the debris is cleared up. The cars are parked between turns one and two.
It's really disappointing. It was a hard hit. We had a good car, and then all of a sudden something happened to us with our brakes, and we started falling back. But I was really happy with our car, and we were running well. And If it's going to happen in front of us this year. It's just been one of those years, and I'm too old for this. It hurts too much, but I think everybody's okay. That was a big hit for everybody.
You just got to see the replay. What did you see from inside the car?
You know what? On Friday in nationwide practice, Leffler spun in front of me and hit the barriers and hit the tire and came right back in front of me. And when I saw Sam go out, I knew he was coming back. There was nothing I could do. And I eyed him, and I knew where he was coming, and I tried to get slowed up. I knew he was coming back, but there was nothing I could do. So I wasn't real sure which one I hit or if I hit both of them. But it was a bigger hit than I want to have again in a little while.
I'm sure he's going to be sore, but I'm glad he's out, and he's smiling. It's a third DNF here in the last five races. Shannon?
Me down here with Sam Hornish Jr., who was also released from the infield care center. Casey Kane did take blame for that, said he got loose and got into you. What happened?
He basically said it the way it was. He got loose and had to correct, and I thought, got me sideways. I thought, well, the tires are probably going to hurt a little bit. I didn't think I was going to get hit by two more cars, so obviously I haven't seen it, but it was a pretty big hit, but the cars are pretty safe. We've always run the carbon seat since we got over here with the beaded inserts, and we do everything we can to try to make them as safe as they can. So a couple bumps and bruises, but all in all, pretty good. So I'm happy about that and looking forward to getting out there and hopefully having a better week next weekend.
Thanks, Sam. Good to see Sam Hornish out of the infield care center. Guys?
Thank you, guys. And, we talked about, you heard Jeff Burton saying he saw it coming. He knew that the 77 was going to come across, but he couldn't get slowed down. DJ, how fast are you going coming out of nine?
Yeah, you're still running upwards of 140 miles an hour coming out of that corner. You're in third gear, and that might be a little bit on the low side coming out of there. But, this is extremely fast, and knowing something's going to happen and stopping your car and missing it, it's two different things. You can't just, these cars are so heavy, it makes it a lot more difficult to slow them down.
Jeff Burton also referred to what happened on Saturday with Jason Leffler, and watch this impact.
Yeah, he just got loose in the same section, and you can see right here, wham, and here comes Jeff Burton. Just like he said, he saw that wreck. Lucky he had enough room to miss him and not wreck himself. And here comes Hornish. Got forced off the racetrack, and then, wow, the same kind of wreck. And then Jeff Gordon and Burton. And destroyed Sam's car.
Just an incredible hit. And, Sam doing a great thing, putting a positive spin on it. He's glad he's all right, but looking forward and hoping he can have a better weekend next weekend.
While we've been sitting here waiting to get this race restarted, we still have 27 laps to go, and it is Scott Speed up front. He'll have to pit, though. It'll be Kyle Busch, Tony Stewart, and Marcus Ambrose when first, second, and third, whenever Speed does pit. And so here's Marcus Ambrose, and let's take a look at the pit time comparison.
Yeah, you see right there where Ambrose just took fuel when he snuck in the pits without Dale and I seeing him. He only was there 5 seconds, but made up a lot of track time. You can see over 10 seconds on the track he made up on Kyle Busch.
Hey, Marcus, Dale Jarrett, you have a copy?
Yeah, g'day, Dale.
Hey, man, looks pretty hot in there.
Yeah, normally I get halfway through the race with a drink bottle that we have in the car, and then we'll start switching out on the pit stops. But because that was a short last pit stop there, we didn't have time to get a drink bottle in. So, I've been working pretty hard. The car's been tough to drive, and I got a bit hot, but I feel a lot better now. I've got the air conditioning on the helmet, and I've had plenty of drinks, so I'm good to go.
Okay, we'll quit talking about that because I know that only makes it worse. Let's talk about something good. You're up in fourth. You've got a chance to win this race.
Yeah, we do. We're still trying to save a bit of fuel. I can see the 14 and the 18, they're running about the same speed as I can. Right now, it's just a matter of just saving two or three laps here on fuel and then having a shootout at the end. Just depends what happens with cautions, but, you know, we haven't had the smoothest race on strategy, so I'm pretty pleased we're actually up this far.
Well, you had me all confused with it. I couldn't even keep up with what you're doing. You're obviously a lot smarter than I was giving y'all credit for. So, but let's talk about tires. You've got some. Your tires have a few more laps on them, but that's not the main thing. You feel like you ran through any debris there?
Well, maybe. You know, there was just a mess over there on the short chute. I don't think I ran over any, but you can't really tell when you're so close behind cars. You know, this car actually comes to life as the fuel burns off. So I'm predicting we're going to get a little better balance here towards the end, even with the older tyres. This brake now anyway will help cool the tyres down.
All right, thanks for talking with us. Stay cool, buddy.
Here's the fuel window now for the cars up front. You see Marcus Ambrose over there, and there you heard Frankie Kerr a minute ago say we may be about a lap or two short. Hard to believe, guys, that the Busch Beans car could possibly run out of gas.
Yeah, he could, but they're counting on some more caution laps, and I don't think this will be the last caution the way they've been racing. So we'll see how how it all plays out.
No, because patience kind of gets wearing thin here as we get down in the latter stages of this race, so I don't think we've seen our last contact.
Watkins Glen International, we are under a red flag here, the fourth caution flag today involving heavy, heavy contact down in between turns 9 and 10. Now the big discussion is fuel strategy, whether some guys can make it, some can't, and what's going to happen these final 27 laps. Let's go down and talk to the crew chief on the 18 car. Dave.
For the first bite of truth, Doc, do you think, on fuel mileage? Well, we'll see what Steve Addington has to say. The M&M's car has had motor and had mileage so far. Do you have enough to get to the end?
Yes.
Both?
We're in good shape. We're in good shape. We've done all the adjusting we can do on it. He's not coming back to see us, so be up to him and see if he can beat him. You know, I'd love to get this M&M's Toyota in victory lane today.
He's had some handling issues. Does he have the fastest car to win, Steve?
Well, I don't know. You get out front and you can run your line, so that makes a big difference. So we'll see how this restart goes here. If we get out front, it goes green, I think we got a good shot. Tony's got a really good car. They can equal each other's lap times, so there's still some good cars that can come up through there. We don't know how this is going to play out, but I'll put my driver in it. I'll take him.
Any day. Shannon?
Yeah, Jeff Gordon out of the Infield Care Center, spirits a little bit high right now, but I know that they took some extra precautions for the back issues that you've had. What were those precautions, and how are you feeling right now, Jeff?
Well, it's just, you know, it's just not what I needed, you know. You take three or four steps forward up to this point, and then you take a hit like that, and you take, you know, a couple steps backwards. So, yeah, it was a heavy impact. You know, I'm just glad Sam's all right. Saw him get wide there off the carousel and come around. I knew he was going to hit the tire barrier and ricochet off, and I just was hoping I'd get by him before he got, you know, out to me, and man, I nailed him and spun him around like a top, and my car just came to a halt and really, you know, took a toll on my back again. So I hate that, but I was real proud of this DuPont Chevrolet team. You know, we didn't have a great weekend going, and the car wasn't, you know, perfect, but we were playing out the strategy. Got caught up in that first incident. Just one of those days, but we're going to ride out, make something out of it. You know, I think Steve Letard had some tricks up his sleeve with the pit strategy, and just you know, wrong place, wrong time.
Jeff, I know you've had hits like this before, and you talk about taking a couple steps forward and a couple steps back with your back. What do you think you're going to have to do this weekend now to get ready for next weekend's race?
Well, Michigan's pretty easy. You know, if we are going to Bristol next week, I'd be concerned. So I got a couple weeks to hopefully heal. You know, I mean, we went through this at Dover. When I hit at Dover, I hurt my back as well. Every time, you know, I hit something, it takes a toll on my back, but it seems to recover. It's just, you know, when you're breaking that hard, it's already pretty tight, and then you hit like that, and it spasms a bit. So we'll be all right.
All right. Thanks, Jeff. Guys, this is Jeff Gordon, the 24 team's first DNF of the season.
Other cars came on pit road. Mark Martin was in. Boris Said was in. Coming in for tires and topping them off with fuel.
Yeah, Boris Said had that overheating problem, had to come in under green. And so now he's taking a chance to get some tires on it. Might as well take them now because he's behind.
Let's listen to Tony Stewart's radio.
Right, bud, just update you on where we're at here. These cautions are going to get us where we're real close to making a full distance. Still need to save all we can here. Do have some thunderstorms starting to pop up about 17, 18 miles away.
Copy that.
So another ingredient here in the strategy, some weather moving in.
Yeah, he's being hopeful that if they do run short on fuel, that they may run short on laps if they have to get rain.
Now, it was 2 years ago that Tony Stewart won this race, but he wasn't the leader with two laps to go. It was Jeff Gordon who had an issue entering turn one. He developed a wheel hop. For exactly what happens and how it happens, let's go down to our ESPN Craftsman Tech Garage and Tim Brewer.
When you're talking about road racing, you have a lot of different scenarios. But road racing, we use a lot of brakes. But when you get into a road race area to where we call wheel hop, what that is, when it occurs, the driver actually backs out of the throttle, deaccelerating the engine, so the dry shaft, the transmission, the rear end is all trying to slow the rear wheels down. But then the driver jumps on the brake pedal, really aggressive. So what that does, it literally tries to change the speed of the rear wheels. So then you've got the drivetrain actually fighting the driver in the car. That's when the wheel hop occurs, when the tire starts jumping off the pavement, getting down into the corner. You've already driven to the point of no return, so the only way you get out of this situation is get off the brake pedal, or my suggestion, push the clutch pedal in, really get on the brakes hard, and hope you don't run out of talent before you get to the wall.
Tim, that's a great explanation. And here's the thing, this can happen to even the best road course racers. And it actually did here to this guy, Boris Said. Let's show you what happened to him in practice on Saturday.
Yeah, he's just trying to test the limits of the car, and he finds out where the limit is on that wheel hop getting into turn 10. Boy, you can see how violent that is just by that shot.
And you can hear the hopping, and he's just trying to hang on. So, and that typically happens late in a race when you're trying to really drive in the corner and jump on those brakes, and suddenly the hopping can cost you a race. Back in a moment.
Okay, race fans, the Jim Beam Toyota is about 10 stalls away. We're going to do four tires, adjustments on the rear shocks. Hang on, this should be fun. We got that one done. We're going to the other side. Just want to give a little bit of shout out. Okay. And we're done, down the way. Just want to give a shout out to all the guys behind the scenes that makes this possible for us to have fun.
Thank you, Hollywood. And we mentioned Robbie Gordon back on the lead lap in 30th position. Interesting lane choice here, guys.
Yeah, the 18 car was the leader here, Dale.
Yeah, he's chosen that outside. We've seen a couple guys make a pass. It'll be interesting to see if this works out for Kyle Busch now.
Let's listen in with our degree V12.
Ready. Green flag. Ready. Green flag. Green. 2x2.
That is the leader's telemetry right there.
Just about in line. Back in line. Top of three. Top of three. Top of three. Top of three.
Two wide.
Top of three.
Clear.
Two wide.
Still out there. You're clear. All clear.
Two wide.
Check it only.
Right door.
Clear.
Just a 00.
Clear by two.
Clear. Clear by half on the six. Clear by two.
The lane choice there might have cost Kyle Busch a lead, but it is Tony Stewart who has the lead now. Kyle Busch in second, Ambrose third, Biffle, Montoya, Pappas, and Carl Weber just made a pass to get a couple of spots all the way up in the seventh position.
I don't know about that choice. I mean, it's easy to second guess, and Kyle knew what he had and what he felt like with his car. But, you know, as the leader, you dictate the start of this race, and I think that inside would have been the proper place because you can get out in front of those guys. That guy, second guy, can't beat you back to the start-finish line.
And the other thing is when you have the inside, you can force the guy on the outside out of the preferred groove. I mean, you don't have to let him have that lane. You can push him completely out of that lane, and that's kind of what Tony did.
Yeah, but it is a driver's choice, and he felt like that was the spot for him to be. As we look out the back of his car here, he's trying to keep Marcus Ambrose behind him.
Possibly a replay of what we saw here on Saturday in the late laps of the NASCAR Nationwide Series race, but Marcus Ambrose was trying to make the pass on Kyle Busch and made it work, entering the bus stop and was able to get the victory.
Yeah, and we see Marcus all the time getting his car, trying to get outside of that driver's mirror. These cars are hard to see out the back. He's trying everything that he can to not let that guy in front of him know exactly where he's at so that he can make a move like he did yesterday. It's a surprise move. Where he's going to do it, they really don't know, so he's just trying to keep these guys guessing at all times.
Gotta believe Kyle Busch is not going to give him that inside move entering the inner loop, but also Marcus very good coming in turn 9. And now Marcus may be under attack a little bit. Look at Biffle up in turn 10.
Yeah, what a great run for Greg Biffle here today. He's doing exactly what he's needed. He's kept himself in the hunt all day. He's trying to go to the outside of Marcus. That's not exactly the spot to be. See if he can make that crossover move and get to the inside of him as they approach turn 1.
He's going to make a move on him here into one. Now
he's on the inside.
He's going to have to outbrake Marcus Ambrose, which is a difficult proposition.
He stayed right there, but he's not going to be able to complete the pass.
Now Montoya is attacking Greg Biffle from behind.
Yeah, when you have to slow down then and get yourself back in line, that allows the next guy to close up on you. But Greg's able to pull away a little bit through the S's, so Montoya probably won't be able to get the run that he needs right here. Really good run again by Greg Biffle and his team doing what they need. You see Clint Bowyer back there, another car that needs a good run here today. These guys, one trying to stay in the top 12, the other trying to get himself closer to that cutoff point for the chase.
Right now, Biffle would gain 3 positions up to 9th if he could hang there in the top 5. Jimmy Johnson in front of the 2 car. John Johnson was the pole sitter, remember, and the 2 car was on the outside front row.
Let's don't forget about the history that we have with the 48 and the 2.
That's right. Yeah, we talked about it at the start. They weren't going to do anything at the start, but I think that push comes to shove right now. See a change here.
Yeah, Kyle Busch has been passed by 2 cars, Marcus Ambrose and Greg Biffle.
So Kyle sliding off the track and having some trouble there, giving up a couple of positions.
And has Ambrose trying to take that spot away too. Dave?
It's the same problem he's had all day. The thing won't turn. That's what he reported to his crew. Just really having trouble with a tight race car that won't turn the way he likes it to.
Now that was Montoya trying to make that pass on Kyle Busch. He wasn't able to do that.
Let's show you what happened in turn 10 when Kyle had his struggles. And you're looking for Marcus Ambrose camera. Watch the pass here.
You can see just Kyle Busch gets in there too hard. And that's that pressure that driver behind you puts on you makes you do things like that.
If you take your eyes off that racetrack for one split second, you can find yourself in the wrong spot and miss your braking point.
So he lost the lead on the restart. He had the outside lane, and now he was pressing and obviously tried to really drive it in turn 10 and lost a couple more positions. Tony Stewart, a 4-time winner here. All 4 of those wins coming in the last 7 starts at this racetrack, is our leader. Marcus Ambrose is second, and Greg Biffle, Kyle Busch, and Juan Pablo Montoya in the top 5. This place has been a home for Tony Stewart. He loves coming to Watkins Glen. He has not finished worse than 2nd the last 5 years he has come here, and 4 times he has stood right here and shouted as a winner.
We're all set then for a cracking end of race here at Watkins Glen International. With me, John Mickel and Tim Scott, replacing David Tupman this week. He's unfortunately couldn't be with us on Monday, although he is watching in and emailing us, as are many other people as well. This is going to be a cracking end to this at the moment, John. I don't think we can actually work out exactly how it's going to end up going. Kyle Busch is now dropping back through the field.
Yeah, it is, and I must admit, I thought Marcus Ambrose was dead and buried with not his new tyres on, but he's actually putting the fastest lap times at the moment and reeling in Tony Stewart, which is amazing that Greg Biffle's in 3rd, Montoya's on his way. I do believe it's going to be quite a good finish to end this race. So I think we're going to bunch up towards the end and looking forward to the last 18 laps.
Tony Stewart out front at the moment, Tim, and with four wins and eight top tens from, what, 10 starts, he's a man that you certainly wouldn't bet any money against when he's in this position at this stage of the race.
No, I mean, he's you know, one of these guys that he knows his pace like the back of his hand. He's got some clean air, pin his ears back. But as John says, you know, Ambrose is more than just keeping Tony Stewart in sight. But Stewart's going to be really hard to beat here. We've got a yellow, looks like it's Tony Stewart comes...
Yeah, we have a caution, obviously. Definitely Tony Stewart's come back to him. So there must be another full course caution for whatever reason it is. Our colleagues are on a break over there at the moment. So we'll be staying on board with Marcus Ambrose for the duration. But you can see the course car out. Tim.
Well, that's going to play a really important role for a lot of these guys' fuel strategy. This other caution coming in now with just 20 laps to go. For Marcus Ambrose, a man we're here with now, I mean, that's crucial. His crew chief, Frank Kerr, said that they really needed another caution to make the fuel stretch to the end.
Well, Tony Stewart, I think, was a little bit tight on it as well and was obviously looking for getting some clean air out there and maybe making a bit of a break and then backing off it just a fraction. But we can go back to our American colleagues now for the very latest to try and find out what that man's strategy is going to be, and of course the rest.
Caution number five here at the Heluva Good at the Glen NASCAR Sprint Cup race. Debris on the racetrack is the reason for the caution flag, and we'll show you where that debris came from.
That's a tire carcass off of, I believe it's Elliott Sadler's car.
Yeah, you watch Elliott trying to pass Casey Mears down into turn one, gets in a little hot, doesn't want to get into Casey and spins out right here. That's not the end of this.
It's actually two wrecks going on at the same time right behind this group. The 55 car and the 6 of David Reagan were fighting for position, getting in the corner right here. You see David Reagan driving under Carpentier. They make contact, and there's Elliott Sadler sitting over there. And hello.
Then the 19 car able to get away, but as he's trying to drive away with an injured car, debris, you see that part of that tire carcass Andy's talking about coming off, and that's what brought the caution flag out for the fifth time by NASCAR.
These are caution laps that quite a few of the leaders needed to make it to the finish. Marcus Ambrose and Tony Stewart are the top two, and they need a little bit more to make it to the end.
Okay, where's Tony Stewart choose this time now?
I'm sure he's going to choose the inside. He saw how it worked last time. He can control the start this time.
Yeah, and he's still got his hands full in trying to keep Marcus Ambrose back there.
And Greg Biffle's had a very good race car. See Biffle back there. The best run that Greg Biffle has had on a road course, certainly his best run here at Watkins Glen. Let's get up to speed with Radio Shack here under caution, starting with Jamie Little and our leader, Tony Stewart.
Well, Doc, just before the caution, Darian Grubb was telling us he was going to be about two laps short. I just asked him, is this going to help you guys? He said, it'll help, but it's not enough to make it to the end. Vince?
Running second is Marcus Ambrose, and of course their strategy, their pitch strategy was up in question earlier in the race when they stayed out long, but it's been a great finish for Ambrose, but he wants to win. He's not points racing today. He's all about the victory, and he's real close to getting it as we reach closer to the checkered flag. Now, behind Ambrose, Greg Biffle. Interesting, Biffle's average finish at Watkins Glen is 29th over the years. That's his worst of all tracks. So to be in the top five here today is huge for their chances to make the chase. They came into today right there on that bubble spot at number 12. Dave?
And Kyle Busch is in the 13th position, just 101 points behind Biffle, trying to make up some ground today. If he finished where he is, they would. The last four races, he's averaged a 25th place finish. And except for his car, which won't turn the way he likes it, he's been pretty good today. Shannon?
Dave, there's so many different strategies right now, both on pit road and big picture, and I'm talking about the chase. Juan Pablo Montoya, the 42 team, and his crew chief, Brian Patty, have been sticking to their guns. They are in chase mode. They want to be in the top 12. Brian Patty told me before the race that their goal here today is a top nine finish. The car is good for Juan Pablo, and they are good on fuel to go to the end. Jamie?
And behind him, Carl Edwards, what a run today. Started 33rd, and he finds himself in sixth right now. It is the best he has been all day. Now, the team told me the same thing that we heard from the 14 of Tony Stewart. They were about two laps short before the caution. this will help, but his crew chief Bob Osborne told him long gears. In essence, that means short shift. Vince?
What a great day it's been for the 13 of Max Pappas. A top 10 finish was their goal today. Crew chief Peter Suspenzo on the radio just a moment ago gave Max his props for a job well done.
You got to hang tough here, bud. That's it. You raced against the best out there in the world, so you're going to be one of them, so you got to do it. And, we're going to go, and you're going to go to win this race. We ain't going to worry about fuel miles. You're just going to run your ass off and try and win the race, all right?
10-4, Peter. I'm ready to go. I feel good now.
Nothing short of victory. That's the goal at this point now for the 13 of Max Pappas. Dave?
The one car and the one team of Martin Truex Jr. very happy with their day. Started 23rd, stayed on strategy, and stayed on the track. That was one of their goals for today, and they've certainly done that. Looking for another top 10 for them and actually pushing toward possibly their best finish of the year. Vince?
Well, and I'll tell you what, guys, you got to give a tip to the hat to that guy right there in the Cheerios car, the 33 of Clint Bowyer. They started 38th today, and they needed a huge day because they came into this 15th in points. This was a day they needed to maintain, not beat themselves, execute all day long, and keep themselves in position for the chase. Well, they've done that and more today. A credit to crew chief Shane Wilson and, of course, the man in the seat with the wheel in his hand, Clint Bowyer. Dave?
Rounding out the top 10, Denny Hamlin in that 11 car. Remember, got that speeding penalty earlier on pit road. Has worked his way back up. Just having a little trouble through the S's behind other cars. That's a high-speed part. That will hurt him. But on fuel, they are to the good. Doc?
Thanks, guys. That's a top 10. And back in 11th and 12th, side by side, will be our pole sitter, Jimmy Johnson, and beside him, Kurt Busch, who started on the outside front row. So 18 laps to go, double foul restart. Stewart and Ambrose, your crew chief, are you believing this about the fuel mileage with these two guys up front?
Well, I believe what they're saying right now, but there's still going to be more cautions. I still would say you're going to have to race them on the track. I wouldn't count on anybody running out of fuel at this point.
Yeah, and Tony leading this race, he can't be conserved. I mean, right now he's been conserving while they've been under caution, but when he gets started right here, he has to go wide open if he has any chance of winning this race. He can't let Marcus get in front of him. See, Tony's chosen that inside line to restart here. He feels like that's his best chance to stay out front. We'll see if Ambrose has anything for him on the outside.
Front row, Tony Stewart on the inside. And remember, Greg Biffle has only gotten one top 10 finish in his career at this racetrack. Having his best run ever, he's going to be very aggressive on the inside in that third position. Here we go, green flag, 18 laps to go at Watkins Glen, and here they come. Look at Ambrose.
Yeah, he didn't even want any part of that outside. He went immediately to the inside. Here comes Kyle Busch on the outside.
Kyle on the outside and Biffle on the inside, two by two, up to the S's.
Yeah, he might make it work on Biffle right here.
Yeah, we saw this yesterday. Kyle Busch did this very thing in the race yesterday.
And look at Carl Edwards. He gets a spot away. He's gone by 42 Montoya and now Biffle.
Biffle's going to have to guard losing another spot to Montoya here.
Montoya's going to make a move on him getting in this bus stop, but Biffle is protecting it. You see him moving to the inside, blocking that move.
Both of those guys are kind of in a conservative mode also, trying to keep themselves inside that chase number.
Team was talking about the big picture with Greg Biffle getting in that chase, and right now if he were to finish where he is, Biffle would move up two places in the points, the 10th spot, with just four races remaining before the chase begins.
Watch Kyle Busch right here. He still has his sights set on trying to get his car back to the front. He wants to be right there in case Marcus Ambrose is able to get beside of Tony Stewart somewhere and see if he can advance his position at least one more.
Carl Edwards, what a job he has done starting at the back of the field today, slowly and just patiently picking them off one by one. Now to be sitting in the fourth position will be 15 laps to go next time by.
And Marcus Ambrose a little bit on the defensive side now. Having to look back there at Kyle Busch, but he gets a good run up through the S's.
It's almost like it takes Marcus's car a lap or two. Plus, he has a little older tires on his car than what Kyle Busch and the rest of these guys do. But it's like it takes his car a little bit to come in.
You see, he keeps seeing Carl Edwards move to the right. He's not really trying to make a move, but here the 48 car, Jimmy Johnson makes a move getting in the bus stop.
You see, Kurt Busch has passed him and a few other cars and moved himself up. He's up to the ninth spot, so he's been able to make a couple of positions on this restart.
Well, Vickers inside of Hamlin there. Just a hint of a touch a moment ago coming out of the bus stop.
Like Boris said, he's got some smoke. I think his car is finally going to blow up here, and they've lost a lot of water throughout the day.
Yeah, they overheated the car out there earlier and finally taking its toll.
Battle for 12th position. Hamlin and Vickers side by side at a turn 11.
They were side by side for over half a lap here. And still side by side getting into turn one.
Let's see what happens here.
See, looks like Vickers forced Hamlin off the racetrack.
And behind him, Casey Kane and Kenseth are side by side, and Hamlin somehow gets back out in front of Casey Kane.
Well, he's still battling right there. Tough spot to go too wide up through there. You see Casey Kane trying to go make a move on Matt Kenseth.
So Boris said has gone to the garage here. You're right, Andy, and has given up. So it's been a tough day for Boris, who had a good run going.
That's too bad.
These guys try to go side by side, Andrew.
And they're doing it. Look at this.
Oh, Kenseth off in the grass trying to stay there.
Still side by side.
Matt Kenseth from 42nd starting spot, now being shown 14th.
Who was it said Matt Kenseth wasn't a road racer?
Yeah, man, he made a great move right there hanging tight.
That was impressive.
He's trying to hang on to 12th position in the point standings and be able to get in that chase again this year.
A.J. Allmendinger there in the battle. See here, Bobby Labonte in there.
And the leaders are all in line. That's why we're showing you all this action here back in the pack. There's Tony Stewart, Marcus Ambrose, Kyle Busch, Carl Edwards, and Greg Biffle.
See some more guys trying to pull out here.
Bobby Labonte gets a tap.
Yep. I think Bobby was already a little loose getting into that corner. Logano's going to go by, so he's recovered from his spin earlier.
I think Robbie Gordon, guys, is picking him off one by one. He's been on and off pit road a couple times once he got back on the lead lap. There he comes in that 7 car.
Yeah, we saw Hollywood Armstrong adjusting on those rear shocks. He must have turned them the right way.
Yeah, I don't know if it's the way Robbie said, but he got him going. So.
He's up to 20th position.
You see Paul Menard right behind Robbie Gordon. And Ryan Newman, who's had a tough day, so to speak, he's worked himself back into the 22nd spot.
Up front, Tony Stewart trying to get win number 5 at Watkins Glen. 14 laps to go. Max Pappas under attack by a very aggressive Kurt Busch, and that is for 7th spot. Dave.
And Doc, he's not exactly happy with his car right now. One thing that was on his mind, his voltage meter was reading 11, which is a little bit low. He switched batteries and he only got it to the other battery, and he only got it to 11.5. So that was on his mind. Plus, he hit a curb hard or something, and he tweaked the front end, as he said it. So it may not be turning exactly the way it has been before. But I'm telling you, like you were saying, he is driving it.
He is wheeling this thing, but he's got a handful of Kurt Busch right here.
Yeah, he's going to have to be on the brakes hard way. He's going to lose that spot here.
And Kurt Busch will get by him on the backstretch, heading into the inner loop and take that spot away.
All right, 2 cars, a fast car. He's off in the grass, though. See if he can hold him back there.
Hey, he just took a shortcut.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, that is a legal spot that you can go through if you're able to hold it, not spin out.
You can hang on to it in the grass.
They let you have that.
The 99 car of Carl Edwards all over the back. Watch him move it inside and outside behind Kyle Busch for position.
Yeah, it's like as they run, get a few laps on the tires, Kyle's car starts giving up, probably in the center of the corner, like he was talking about, where he's had a difficult time in making his car turn.
Starting to see a few shaded places on the racetrack, and that could change the way this track affects different cars. It could help Kyle Busch.
Kyle Busch right now just on the outside of the top 12 in points, looking in 13th position. He has only had one top 10 finish in the last 9 races, that being a 7th up at Loudoun, New Hampshire.
Well, the thing with Kyle Busch here, he wants to be able to go and be aggressive right here, but he's got himself right now. Carl Edwards tried to make a move to the inside. Kyle keeps him back there, but he's got himself within about 55 points of that cutoff spot. We got another battle going on here with Martin Truex and Jimmy Johnson.
That's for 10th position. Truex really showing what a good road racer he is.
This is a really good track for Martin Truex. He's done a great job up here, finishing the top 5 last year.
Yeah, another driver just in front of them, Clint Boyer, that was needing a good solid day, and he's been able to produce that with his team. This is the point of the race as a driver, that you've got yourself in a good spot. You're just hoping kind of things settle out here, the guys that were needing a good day. Continue on here, and if you can make spots, good.
We've seen Carl Edwards duck out almost every straightaway, and I don't know if he's trying to keep his car cool or whether he's just trying to get out of the mirror or the car in front of him.
I think he's guarding that inside spot more. He just wants anybody behind him to know that if you've got any ideas about this, you're going to have to go to the other side to try to make your pass.
He's been pretty consistent with that move. I mean, even when he's not in a position to make a pass, he pulls over to the right pretty far.
You can see right there. Yeah, and it's just, and again, these things are hard to see out of, so he might be trying to get a little better view of exactly where that car is, even using this side mirrors and things.
And Kyle Busch runs off the racetrack.
And this time, Edwards will have a shot underneath him.
See Kyle trying to hang on, but just can't. Now he's going to have to worry about Greg Biffle trying to take that next spot away.
And that's going to be up in turn 10. Kyle will have the inside line in turn 10 as they turn left.
Doesn't seem like Kyle's able to turn his car and get it to where he's wanting it to go. And the more he tries to force the issue and he gets that pressure on him, then you see him make the mistakes.
The best spot of the day for Carl Edwards, all the way to third position. Carl started back in 33rd spot.
We've seen Tony Stewart be consistently faster than Ambrose. I just wonder if they think that Tony's going to run out of fuel and they're just staying where they want to.
We haven't had a chance to talk much about Mark Martin today, the winningest driver this year. And although he is a three-time winner here, it has been a bit of a struggle all weekend for Mark. And right now, if he were to finish where he is, he would lose another spot in the point standings and move back to 11th position.
Well, it has been a long weekend. They just haven't gotten the car to Mark's liking. They really just haven't had speed. And Mark says the harder he tries to go, the slower that he goes.
And there are the point standings. We might mention in Mark's defense, you know, he hasn't been here in 2 years, and so he hasn't been on a road course but once. That was at Infineon early in the year with this new car. And you see how close it is for that 12th spot. Kyle Busch now just 58 points back. It was over 100 when the day began. He was behind Matt Kenseth. Tony Stewart, they say they're iffy on fuel. So was the Marcus Ambrose car. Here is Carl Edwards back in third spot. He stands to be the big gainer. And by the way, Carl has never won on a road course. One of the surprising thoughts when we come here and realize he's been good so many places, but he's never won a road course race in Sprint Cup competition.
Yeah, with only two a year, there's not that many opportunities, and a lot of great road racers out here.
Yeah, you have to have a lot of things to go right if you're going to get yourself in that position. And as long as Tony Stewart's racing, you really have a difficult time in winning one.
Well, he's in pretty good company because Jimmy Johnson's never won on a road course either, and Jeff Burton and some other guys there that have been awfully good at other places. There's Jimmy Johnson coming by, and he's being shown back at 11th spot.
So we're inside of 10 laps now. If Marcus Ambrose has any thoughts of running up there, I think we'll start seeing if he can run Tony Stewart down.
Let's check in on Tony Stewart. Jamie.
Well, Doc, you mentioned points a little while ago, and I'm sure there's a lot of Tony Stewart fans listening in right now wondering if their driver has clinched a spot in that top 12 for the chase. If it ended right now, he's 756 points above 13th place, and that would be Kyle Busch. That is not enough to clinch a spot. He will have to wait till next week. And as of right now, he has 257 points over Jimmy Johnson in second. That is by far the biggest lead he has had this season, guys.
You're right, Jamie. He'd need to leave here with a 781-point lead over the 13th-place car to clinch a spot in the chase. I don't think you have to worry about him being in the chase, but it'd be nice to know, I guess, if you're Tony Stewart, that when you leave here, you're in.
He's virtually clinched. He can actually run these races just like he has clinched, because he's not worried about that.
Here's a 26 car, Jamie McMurray, who had been in the garage here early to change the transmission, back on the racetrack and now showing some smoke out of the back of his Ford.
He still have some kind of problem here.
Yeah, and this is we talk about Tony Stewart and the points lead that he has. That's what's allowing him to really take a chance here. You know, if they happen to run out on the last lap, it's not going to be a big deal. Other than the fact that he wants to win.
And as far as taking chances are concerned, Marcus Ambrose has nothing to lose and everything to gain to be able to try to run him down and be as aggressive as he wants to be to win a race.
Looks like that gap's closed up a little bit there. Yeah, about 0.6 of a second. Closer than what it was the previous lap.
Yeah, we see Marcus Ambrose starting to push his car a little bit more. He's picked up about 0.3 of a second over the last few laps. What's going on with him, Vince?
Well, they're urging Marcus Ambrose to keep digging. But remember a while back, they were a couple of laps short on fuel, and then we had that red flag. So they weren't able to save as much as you might have hoped, or they might have hoped. I just asked crew chief Frankie Kerr, are you sure you've got enough to go to the end? He had a very nervous look on his face, raised his eyebrows. I'm not sure that they're as confident that they're going to make it as they'd like to be.
I think they got a lot of company too, Vince. I don't think there's a lot of cars out here that feel real confident in that fuel range that they have.
We get a green-white checkered, you may have the guy back in 13th spot win this race.
No telling. A lot of guys would like to see, a lot of teams would like to see another caution flag. But we're down inside now, 7 laps to go.
We were talking on the way out of the racetrack here yesterday, DJ, about Marcus Ambrose. He's such a nice guy, and he doesn't like to ruffle any feathers and push and shove people around. But, I mean, what as you watch his onboard telemetry, what about if you're Marcus Ambrose and you get close enough, would you be willing to be put a little bumper on Tony Stewart to get that first win?
Well, he told us before the race started that, yeah, he was ready to take that to the next level. And I think that the other thing that he went on to say is these other guys understand the position he's in versus what they're in. He might get a little bit more room from them if he's able to get to their bumper.
He's still got a lot more work to do before he's going to have a chance to do that, though. He's got to close this gap on Stewart.
Yeah, he's got to get to the bumper. And actually, Tony Stewart beat him a little over a tenth the last lap.
Center loop is where Ambrose has been so good in his career here. Closes a little bit there, able to be pretty polished through there.
Well, he told us that his car seems to get better, maybe doesn't fall off as much as the fuel burns off. So he's going to have a lot of the fuel burn off. They're not going to have much left here shortly.
He's going to hope he doesn't burn it all off. He's closing the ground just a little bit.
See, there's about a 3-second gap back to the third place car of Carl Edwards and Kyle Busch, Biffle. Montoya in sixth.
I have to say Biffle has been the surprise of this race for me because he's a great race car driver, but this is a really good race he's put together so far.
And it's just like they did everything right today. They stayed on their strategy. Biffle kept on track, didn't press the issue anywhere to get himself in a bad spot. So a really good day for him. I think Montoya's done kind of the same thing. As much as he would like to go up there and try to win this race, he's doing exactly what he needs to do.
Yeah, he's been very focused on this. There's Dale Jr. just coming out of the pits. But he's been very focused on their big goal, and that's to make this chase.
See, Ambrose really good through that part. He actually gains a little on Tony, but I think as they get around turn nine, Tony is able to put a little more distance back on. Here we see Jimmy Johnson and Denny Hamlin battling. These guys are just outside the top 10, 11th and 12th.
I bet Stewart's saying, boy, if it wasn't for Ambrose back there, I could save a little bit of fuel. But he looks in that mirror every time, sees that 47.
These are two guys early in the race here that we thought were going to be battling maybe just like this, but it would be for maybe first and second, and it hasn't panned out for either one of them. So we see Denny Hamlin trying to take that spot away now.
Trying to stay in and not lean on the champ, and he's able to make the pass there in turn 10.
Yeah, that was a smart move by Jimmy Johnson because that's a risky place on the track to try to contest that spot.
See, right behind them is Brian Vickers, who came in the last time and got tires. He's worked his way back to the 13th spot.
Tony Stewart trying to get his third win of 2009. It would be his fifth win here at Watkins Glen, which will make him the all-time winningest NASCAR driver at this historic racetrack. And but the questions are, how much fuel do they have? And take a look at Edwards and Ambrose, pretty darn close. Tony looks like he has a little more than those other two.
He has one lap more fuel than Ambrose if we look at their last pit stop. Tony Stewart made his on lap 56, and Ambrose made his on 55, so that's the difference there. And actually, Carl Edwards made his on 54, so if we want to look at cars in that running order that probably have the least amount of fuel or the most laps on this tank of fuel, it would be Carl Edwards.
it's going to be a matter of who did the best job under the cautions that they had of saving the fuel and whose carburetor's a little better right here.
And here's the bad news, DJ. At a course like this, if you run out of fuel in the last lap, there are still 28 cars on the lead lap.
Yeah, I mean, you don't make it back. You finish behind all of them.
But all of these guys that are up front there are in a position to gamble pretty much. You know, all of them pretty solidly. Well, the two guys, Carl Edwards and Tony Stewart, solidly in the chase part. Marcus Ambrose doesn't have a chance really of finding himself in that top 12. So they're all three in a position to gamble some.
Saving fuel, buddy. Saving fuel.
Yeah, saving just a little.
Save a little more.
Well, that's a little tough to do at this point.
Well, we have seen Carl Edwards drop back a little bit, and I think he's, because as you pointed out, he was the first one of those cars on pit road that he's having to do a little bit more, just try to salvage that third place.
Well, this is one of the teams that gambled on having more caution laps than we've had so far, and I'm actually surprised we haven't had more caution laps, and the red flag is what caused that. They didn't get to run any laps off while they were cleaning the track.
Marcus Ambrose now gained 0.4 that time on Tony Stewart. Three laps to go for Ambrose, and if he were to finish second, it would be a career best finish, but he's not thinking about career best right now. He's thinking about winning a race.
He wants that W.
Two laps to go here.
Whoop.
Wow.
Thank God. Ambrose struggling just a little bit getting into turn one.
Yeah, it looked like he was just kind of chasing it pretty hard there, trying to gain some more spots. And
he's just pushing, trying to make up some spots or some ground here on Stewart. He feels like if he could get closer to Stewart, he could maybe either force in a mistake or just have a chance to surprise him like we saw on Saturday with Kyle Busch. Just can't get there, though. Tony Stewart just so solid.
We talked about how Tony Stewart's car didn't look that steamy in the final practices or most practices all day on Saturday, but he didn't need to look good on Saturday.
That's right. It wasn't time to show your cards. He's got them all on the table now, though. Pretty good hand so far.
In the 26-year history of NASCAR racing at Watkins Glen, there has never been a last lap pass here for the victory. And if it's going to happen, it needs to happen right now. White flag for Tony Stewart, and there's the interval back between Stewart and Ambrose.
Well, it's all about the fuel now. There's not going to be a pass unless something happens as far as the fuel goes.
Okay, it's gut check time right now. You got to think even both of them are thinking about saving. Just try to feather foot it up through here, because the only thing that's going to lose it for him is running out of fuel.
Yeah, but if you're the 47, you don't want to lose contact with him in case that happens coming out of the last corner.
Yeah.
You want to be able to have that opportunity.
The top six cars are very, very close on fuel. Got to be wondering if they can make it another half a lap. Tony Stewart trying to make it and win the race. Marcus Ambrose trying to make it and finish second, or maybe hope Tony Stewart doesn't.
Looks like they're going to make it. This is going to be the critical corner here.
The one car, Martin Truex, we are told slowing over in the back of the course. He may be out of fuel.
Great run by Tony Stewart today, though. Showed why he's so good.
Coming out of turn 11, it will be official. Tony Stewart wins at Watkins Glen. Marcus Ambrose, best career finish in second spot, and Carl Edwards will come home from the back of the pack in third. Kyle Busch fourth. Greg Biffle, the first ever top five here.
Montoya, Kurt Busch, and Max Pappas with a great run up in the eighth spot today.
Yeah, top 10 was a good day for Pappas, and they brought it home in there.
Tony Stewart, what a...
All right, boys. Way to get her done.
Talked about Superman and Watkins Glen. He's finished first or second the last now 6 years in a row here at this racetrack.
Yeah.
Let's go down and visit with his crew chief, Shannon.
Well, Doc, the fingernails are still on Darian Grubb's fingers. A little bit of nerves up there. I know Tony's at one of the best at saving fuel, but how close were you guys?
We're pretty close. He probably doesn't have enough for a burnout or anything right here, but Tony's a great road course racer, and his record here speaks for itself, so we're just glad we didn't mess it up and got that Old Spice off Depot Chevrolet into victory lane.
Your third win, Darian. We talk about momentum, and we talk about a rhythm to the chase. How close are you guys where you want to be if this chase were to start right now?
I'm not going to lie, we still got work to do. We're trying to get stronger every week, and this was a testament to what effort we put forth with road course races. We know how good Tony is here, so as an entire organization at Stewart Haas, I can't thank them enough for everything that they did, and we're going to get stronger. Hopefully we can carry that momentum into the chase.
Well, good luck to you guys. Tony Stewart gets another victory here at Watkins Glen. Doc?
And he becomes the all-time winningest NASCAR driver here at Watkins Glen. His fifth victory in eight races. Two second-place finishes, and the points lead for Tony Stewart continues to be extended. What a day for Smoke here, getting his third win of the 2009 season.
Kyle Busch knocked a big chunk off of that deficit that he had to get in this chase.
Yeah, and got some really good races coming up for him. So Michigan, Bristol, and Atlanta before we get to that cutoff at Richmond.
Listen to this crowd as Tony Stewart now comes by. His crew standing on the wall.
These fans have been excited every time Tony came by in the lead today or if he was making a pass right here. They appreciate the talent that's there.
It seemed like this was a Tony Stewart day. Every time we saw him come by after he makes a move, we could see all the hands from the crowd coming up.
It's amazing. After all the success he had driving for Joe Gibbs over the years, all those other wins coming as a driver for Joe Gibbs, getting his own team started, and now for the first time as a car owner slash driver, Tony Stewart wins on a road course.
I thought Grubb said he didn't have enough fuel for a burnout.
Yeah.
That's a good one.
It saved a lot of fuel. It wasn't even close.
Now let's go down where Dave Burns is caught up with Kyle Busch.
And Kyle finished fourth today. Kyle, what were you fighting in your race car today?
Everything. Wouldn't turn, wouldn't leave, wouldn't stop, wouldn't accelerate, everything. Just, I'm tired. That wore me out right there. I had to drive everything I had that was worth that car. And I could barely hang on to fourth, so, great work by all the M&M's team guys. You know, they did a good job this weekend. We fought hard, and that was three times harder than I had to drive here last year, and last year we spanked them.
And as they fight to get in the chase, that was the kind of drive they needed from Kyle. Guys?
And he drove hard, and that put him within 58 points now of 12th spot in the chase. And Max Pampas out of gas. He got to get a push to get back in. Career best finish for Max, for Mad Max, 8th on the day. His best finish before was 12th at Infineon back in June.
Yeah, back to Kyle Busch. Some days, as a driver, you just have to earn your money a little more than other days. You don't have that perfect car, so it's up to you to get the job done, and he did his job. Came home in the top five.
Tony Stewart headed to victory lane. Third win of 2009, and now just four races remain until the chase begins, and here are the point standings. You see Tony Stewart, Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, who did not finish, back in third. The big gainers, Juan Pablo Montoya up another spot after gaining two last week. And Greg Biffle up two positions. Kyle Busch just 58 points back. He was 101 back when the day began, outside of that 12th spot to get in the chase. If you like what you saw today, we have lots more coming your way. Michigan next week, Bristol, Tennessee, Atlanta, Richmond. You can read the races coming up. Tickets to the chase, www.nascar.com/tickets are available, and it should be exciting. Last four races to the chase, and then the chase beginning for the sixth year here in NASCAR Sprint Cup competition. Let's visit with our second place finisher, Shannon.
A great weekend for Marcos Ambrose. A win on Saturday, a second place finish on Monday. How was the car today, Marcos?
Yeah, it was just great. You know, we've had a trying weekend. Both cars were difficult when we got it out of the truck on Friday, but we worked hard at it. The Cup car was just a little aggressive to drive, and I had to work really hard to keep up with Smoke there, and I was closing in, but he just didn't make a mistake. What a fantastic driver he is. He's just unbelievable, and I just feel privileged to be racing against him and driving for my team. I'm just so proud of all my guys. They've just given me great stuff all year, and JTG Doherty's here to stay with the help of Michael Waltrip Racing, and it's just really exciting times for us, and Little Debbie's on the car. They've been off our car the last few races. They're back on board, and I got them a good result, so congratulations to them, and I can't wait to have a shower and lie down. I'm pretty whipped.
Well, let me throw some numbers at you real quickly before you lie down. Third last season in this race, second this season. I guess we can expect to see you back next year and try to go for that number one spot.
I'll try. As long as the team will have me, I'll drive for them.
All right. Marcos Ambrose, second place finish. Doc?
Career best finish for Marcos Ambrose. You can see he is absolutely exhausted. Well, Tony Stewart has made it into victory lane, a place he's very familiar with here at Watkins Glen. And it is time to go down for our degree V12 victory lane.
And Tony Stewart unbuckling, took a big swig of water. These guys earned it today. Tony Stewart started lucky number 13th, and he ended up victorious for the fifth time here at Watkins Glen. Tony, that first pit stop, you sounded like a crew chief over the radio saying exactly what you wanted to do to this car. All those changes you guys made, including spring rubbers, how crucial was that to get to the lead?
It was big. We weren't good enough at the beginning to win, but just needed to make some changes to get better. And I was the one that asked to go the opposite direction there after happy hour. So Darian and the guys did an awesome job on the pit stop. I mean, it was a pretty in-depth change and stuff that took a little bit of time. And I think we only lost six spots in the pits. So to do those changes that they did, the pit crew did an awesome job. But that put the car back where it needed to be.
Knowing this was a fuel strategy race, how close you guys were, how much were you looking in that rearview mirror knowing that was Marcos Ambrose?
I was watching him. I mean, there were parts of the track we were stronger than he was, and there were parts of the track he was stronger than us, but I think we were stronger in the parts of the track that we needed to be to hold him off if he got any closer, but I never looked at the fuel. I never worried about it once we went back to green.
Darian Grubb, your crew chief, said last night, this type of race today on Monday was going to play into your hands. What is it about this hot and slick kind of track that just suits you?
I love it when it gets slick, but this is my house right here. This we ran really, really well over the last 7-8 years here, so just thank our fans for sticking it out. I mean, I know it's a lot for a lot of those people to take off an extra day of work when they needed to be there today to come watch this race, and we appreciate them doing that, but it's nice, too, to get Old Spice finally in victory lane this year. It's the first time that we've got all of our sponsors in. We got Office Depot and Burger King and now Old Spice now, so we've completed the trifecta now, so I'm pretty happy for that because Old Spice has been with us for a long time, and glad to finally get him in victory lane this year.
Tony, your first four wins here came with Joe Gibbs. This is your first road course win as a team owner in the 14. What does that mean?
The same as it did when we won the All-Star race in Pocono. It's a great feeling, but it's all due to these guys at SHR, Bobby Hutchins and Darian Grubb and Tony Gibson, Ryan Newman, all these guys in the Hendrick engine and chassis department. Rick sent me a message this week and said, hey, don't you think it's about time for another win? So this one's for you, Rick, buddy.
All right, your points leader is 260 points ahead of second place, Jimmy Johnson. Doc?
Tony Stewart is king of the Glen. We'll take a quick break. When we come back, we've loads more analysis here. Stay with us. It was a physical race at the Glen, tough, and it was tough Tony who ends up as king of the Glen in the 14 car. One more time, Marcos Ambrose, the Australian, looked like he could close him down. In the end, though, he never had enough, gentlemen. John Mickel and Tim Scott, strategy-wise, Darian Grubb was obviously lying about the fuel that Tony Stewart had left on board.
That won't be the first time, will it?
No.
No, but a great race from Tony Stewart. Marcos Ambrose surprised me as well. I didn't think he had a good enough car that to finish with. But Tony Stewart, he goes on from strength to strength and gets better and better and better. Five wins at Watkins Glen.
Five wins in the last eight races at Watkins Glen. That's the kind of record he's got at the moment. Cousin Carl must have thought he was going to do a Mark Martin from third place because he was waiting for the two front cars just to drop out with fuel loss, but no.
Yeah, I mean, he must have sort of been counting his chickens because thinking that those two racing each other hard might actually 40, Ambrose nothing to lose with no chase prospects really, so pushing Stewart, and maybe they would have run out of fuel. But Carl Edwards, I think, would be very happy with third.
That's from 33rd place on the grid. I mean,
it's a terrific rise up through the field, very clean race, and of course he nearly got taken out in the Kevin Harvick incident, so did very well to recover from that.
With the exception of that Kevin Harvick incident and many others, it was a very physical race, even if you didn't get involved in any shenanigans, wasn't it? I mean, all of those drivers looked like they were worn out at the end of it.
I think these cars are so big and clumsy around this track, Keith, that they're fighting the car all the time to get the speed out they need, like fighting the cobbles, making sure they're keeping the car straight, braking hard. It's a very physical track, and I think every driver will get out of that car there is very exhausted, and they'll be glad of the rest.
We've got Michigan coming up next, another discipline completely compared with this one. The road courses are out of the way now. If anything, now it's time to focus on the crucial chase, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, the five races run into the final chase, so that's, I think all the teams now know what they've got to do, and we're going to see quite a lot of percentage play on the ovals.
Of course, the previous Michigan race was that Mark Martin race, yeah, where he snuck up on them. I'd almost forgotten that.
Yeah, Jimmy Johnson ran out of fuel, then Greg Biffle ran out of fuel, then Mark Martin won. So, you know, I suppose Jimmy Johnson wants to put the record straight when they go back next week.
We're still concentrating on, though, Kyle Busch just outside of that top 12 again, despite having a good run today, Tim.
Yeah, but today I thought was good. You know, he kept his nose clean and clearly was fighting the car. And to come home with maximising what you can do on the day with fourth place, that's maximum points you really could have got out of that car if it was such a handful. And that's exactly what he's got to be able to do in the remaining races.
Indeed it is. That's all, though, for today. But there's more racing from the States coming up. NASCAR returns at the weekend with race 23 of the Sprint Cup. Join us on Sunday evening for the Carfax 400 from Michigan International Speedway. Live coverage begins at 7 p.m. on Sky Sports Extra. My thanks to John Mickle and Tim Scott for joining me, and thanks to you, of course, for watching. We look forward to your company on Sunday, but for now, congratulations to Tony Stewart, who a day late was crowned King of the Glen.
Stop me, I know full well what I'm doing. I got time on my hands, soul on my tongue. Now I'm going downtown, I'm gonna get myself stung. Yeah, crazy, 'cause all I wanna do is run.
More sport, news and views at skysports.com.